Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the ninth meeting in 2017 of the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee. Could I remind everyone, please, to put their mobile phones on silent? No apologies have been received, so we're going to move straight on to the agenda item one, which is to consider Brexit and its implication on fisheries. It's going to be a roundtable discussion to discuss the implications of the outcomes of the EU referendum for Scotland. This is the first in a series of sessions that the committee will undertake today, and we're particularly focusing today on fisheries. Now, what I propose to do is, as a roundtable discussion, is to go round the table and ask everyone to introduce themselves. I would like to point out to those people that haven't been to a committee meeting before, the committee is supported by a clerking team, the official report, and the gentleman over there who, when I nod at him, will cut you off if you're speaking for too long. But what we'll do is we'll work round the table, if I may, with everyone introducing themselves. As far as the MSPs are concerned, maybe you could just introduce who you are and where you're from. So I'll start that off and we'll work to the left. My name's Edward Mountain and I am a Conservative regional MSP for the Highlands and Islands.
Hi, I'm Peter Chapman. I am a Conservative regional MSP for the North East region, and I am Shadow Rural Economy and Connectivity Shadow Cabinet Secretary.
Bertie Armstrong, Chief Executive of the Scottish Fishermen's Federation, which is the trade association that looks after a large portion of the catching sector in Scotland.
Mary Evans, and I'm an SNP MSP for Angus North and Mearns.
Good morning, I'm Michael Bates. I'm the Group Manager for the Scottish Seafood Association based in Peterhead. We are a membership organisation representing the fish processing sector.
Jamie Green, MSP, Conservative Regional MSP for the West of Scotland and party spokesman on connectivity.
Morning, Scott Landsburgh. I'm the Chief Executive of the Scottish Salmon Producers Organisation. That's the salmon farmers.
Martin Vann, morning. John Finney, Green MSP for the Highlands and Islands.
Morning, Richard Lyle, SNP MSP for Uddingston and Belsong.
Mike Rumbles, I'm the Liberal Democrat MSP for the North East of Scotland and spokesperson for everything on this committee.
Robin Churchill, Professor Emeritus of International Law, University of Dundee.
Stuart Stevenson, SNP member, Bamshire and Buchan Coast.
Calum Duncan, I'm the head of Conservation Scotland for the Marine Conservation Society.
Rhoda Grant, Highlands and Islands Labour MSP.
Alistair Sinclair, National Coordinator for the Scottish Creel Fishermen's Federation.
John Mason, I'm MSP for Glasgow Shettleston.
Gail Ross, SNP Constituency MSP for Caithness Sutherland and Ross, and Deputy Convener of this committee.
Okay, thank you. We seem to have got round well, and I hope that you, during the course of the discussions, and we've split this discussion section up into themes, that you will all sort of try and look towards me so I can try and bring you in. The aim is to bring you all in, to make you feel included, so try and catch my eye. And what I would also urge is that if you feel you're going on for a bit of time, try and catch my eye as well, because I may want to stop you. And that saves me calling you out and asking you to reduce what you're saying. So if you could do that, and it really, it is meant to be a chance for everyone to have the opportunity to say something. So the first theme that we'd like to investigate as part of the committee is the benefits of being part of the Common Fisheries Policy and the EU. And John, you had a question which you thought might stimulate discussion on that.
Yeah, we could try that. I mean, I'm not an expert on fishing, so you can take it I'm a kind of layperson in this area. But, I mean, I hear different things about the Commons Fishery Policy. I hear some people saying it's the worst thing that ever has been, and we want totally rid of it, and there's nothing to learn from Europe. And I hear other people saying if it wasn't for the Common Fisheries Policy, there would be no fish left in the sea. So is it entirely good? Is it entirely bad? Or is there anything we can take from it?
Who would like to... Bertie, I'm quite concerned about you, but But I'm sure you're the right person to lead off, yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Governor. I take your comments about brevity and keeping an eye on control. The CFP, Europe is not composed of stupid people, and the CFP is not written by stupid people. It's two problems, as far as to approach it from a slightly different angle. Its two problems are it allows common access, common grazing, to our waters. That was the norm when we entered the EU. Everybody fished everywhere, aside from the territorial limits, and there were no quotas. That was perpetuated and has created a great disadvantage. The second point is the difficulty of organizing this sort of thing between 28 going on 27 member states. It is, and I could produce evidence as long as your arm, the CFP operation is a uncomfortable stumble towards compromise, and nothing happens quickly. So there are much better ways of doing that. Having said that, it of course, within those constraints and our enormous personal disadvantage in this land, at the same time that the CFP existed, capacity has just about right-sized itself, and the fish stocks for the last, since the turn of the millennium, have been going very much in the right direction, and fishing mortality, which was far too high, is coming down. So, it's the wrong process for us, and we'd be much better out of it. But on the other hand, it has not been a complete disaster, recognizing that we are hugely disadvantaged and that it is a very cumbersome and wrong process to run a sea area in.
Stuart, you wanted to come back on that.
I think, speaking as a politician, that the CFP has presented some challenges in the way it makes decisions. If the parties that were round the table making decisions were limited to those states that have fishing interests, it would have made rather more sense than we had a period, for example, in the not hugely distant past, when the commissioner was an Austrian, you know, a country without any maritime interests of any kind. So I think that has made the decision-making process unnecessarily cumbersome. It has exposed the decision-making process to the political risk that countries who've no direct stake in fishing have used their influence in the decision-making around the common fisheries policy as a trade-off for entirely unrelated matters. And that has both slowed things down and led to suboptimal outcomes. So I think, you know, from a politician's point of view, that would be one of the starting places for saying that in its present form, the CFP is not fit for purpose.
Mary, did you want to come back with a question?
Yeah, it was. It was just on some of the you talked about before we entered the CFP, and it was really just to get a bit more information about historically what that position was like and how the fish stocks were doing at that time as well, when it was just, essentially was a free-for-all for people fishing in each other's waters, yeah. And just to get a bit more information. Then. Yeah,
there's an easily traceable story which can quickly be scanned across. In the beginning, everyone thought, to really generalise, that the sea was a bottomless pit of resource and that we should have at it with the greatest of alacrity, which is roughly what happened. The war intervened and fishing lessened, so stocks increased. There was a phenomenon known as and we have a subject matter expert in the gallery here. There was a phenomenon known as the Gadoid outburst, which, to cut a long story short again, meant there was an awful lot of fish in the northern continental shelf. So everybody had at it with a will under those circumstances of basically a free-for-all, and the inevitable happened, and we had to we had to one way or another arrive at an arrangement. But by that stage it was too late for us. The way the international community, again to hugely generalize, the way the international community went about this was to put somebody in charge, which was the coastal state in whose waters this resource lay. Too late for us. The coastal state for us was the European Union, with all the problems that Stuart has just described of vested interest.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Callum, you wanted to come in there, and then I'll come back to John.
Yeah, thanks, Edward. Clearly, we all want to get to healthy seas with sustainably managed stocks. That requires collaboration. that supports thriving coastal communities, that has to respect environmental and ecosystem limits. So that's the important outcome from our perspective. In terms of getting there, we mustn't throw the baby out with the bathwater. There's a lot of good outcomes and articles within the Common Fisheries Policy. So, you know, let's not think about completely starting from scratch. There's a lot of good in there. I mean, as Bertie alluded to, reform management has led to and the industry coming on board and the Scottish fleet particularly taking some progressive measures has got us to a place where the fishing capacity matching the opportunity. We've gone from 90% stocks being overexploited in 2005 to 47% now. Other good elements I'd like to point out was in the CFP are things like Article 4, an ecosystem-based approach to fisheries management, an integrated approach to managing fishing within ecologically meaningful boundaries. And it's these sort of aspirations that we need to take forward. Article 17, I'm sure we all support that in terms of setting transparent and objective criteria to meet environmental, social and economic benefits. We'd like to see end of wasteful discards. There's maybe better ways to do that, but we all agree that's a good thing. And probably world-leading regulations to protect the deep sea, some of the most vulnerable ecosystems on Earth. So the deep sea access regime, which finally came through in 2016, protecting vulnerable ecosystems deeper than 800 metres some shallower than 400 as well. So there's a lot of hard work gone into getting the elements of the CFP to deliver collaborative management within ecosystem limits. That's whatever our arrangements are, I think we can all agree that's where we want to get to.
I mean, I think it's interesting, and maybe people will want to develop whether the conservation and the work that they're doing to stop the overexploitation of fish species is being led by the EU or fishermen or both. Robin, you wanted to come in, and then John wanted to come back.
Thank you. I think it's worth bearing in mind that the Common Fisheries Policy is not just about the catching side, but also about marketing, trade and structural aid. But I assume the main interest today is on the catching side. To come back to the original question, I think it's probably fair to say that up until 2010 at least, the Common Fisheries Policy was a complete disaster in managing stocks. The Commission admitted that itself in a paper published in 2009 when it said that most stocks are being fished at unsustainable levels. And the reasons for that, in brief, are that total allowable catches were set by politicians way above the limits recommended by scientists from the International Council for the Exploration of the Sea. There was often poor enforcement. There was a large amount of overcapacity in EU fleets. In other words, there was more vessels and more catching power to catch the fish than was justifiable on any economic scale. And it's taken a long time to try and reduce capacity. There are some indications that since the Common Fisheries Policy was reformed in 2013, that the management has improved. There seems to be a better correlation now between total allowable catches and scientific recommendations.
John, did you want to?
Yeah, it was just on that kind of theme, and quotas were mentioned that before we were in the EU and the Common Fisheries Policy, there weren't quotas. And so I suppose, again, as a layperson, my fear would be if we're out of it, is there a danger it does become a free-for-all again and there's no control?
Who would like to go on that? But Bertie, would you like to?
Very briefly. Yeah, I don't think there is a fear of that. I don't think that's, if we handle this properly, I don't think there's a possibility of that. We've just come from a study visit to Norway, and their central top overriding priority is stock sustainability, because all other good things fall from that. We should take a leaf firmly out of that book, and in retaining the good bits of the CFP, that should be the central aim. So What was emphasised this morning at the seminar was the fish are actually in our EEZ, to cut a long story very short. They're zonally attached to our EEZ. So there can't be a free-for-all. No other country can say, I'm just going to catch anyway, because they'd have to come here to catch anyway. Again, to generalise a little, and under international law, that is our right and responsibility to regulate that. So there's every possibility of getting this sustainably right for the future.
Okay.
For the record, can we just say EEZ is exclusive? Economic zone. Is that correct? Yes, that's
perfect. Reda.
I think I was just wanting to pull it back a wee bit to, you know, some of the things that Calum had talked about. Are surely things we could replicate if we were out of the EU, the kind of setting quotas and how we manage it. But I suppose what my question is, how do we then negotiate that with other people who have an interest? And Bertie was saying that all the fish are in our EEZ. Roughly, I mean, there's obviously we have interests out with that as well, people fishing out with that area. So I'm wondering, you know, where are the real differences about being part of this big family that manages it or being out there on our own?
Right, I think that's a very important point, and we're going to sort of develop that a bit under theme three. So maybe if I could just part that just slightly at the moment and see if we can come back to the good and the bad, as it were, of the EU. Peter, sorry, Reda, I'll bring you in on that one, Peter.
I just wanted to follow up a bit on what Robin Churchill was saying about there was too much catching ability, you know, a few years back, and we've now got that into better balance and we've reduced capacity. Would you like to comment on where the vast bulk of the reduction in capacity took place? Because the feeling is that the vast reduction in capacity took place in Scotland rather than in other EU countries. Is that fair to say that?
To be honest, I'm not sure. It's some time since I looked at the figures for reduction in capacity. But, I mean, one of the problems with capacity is that if it's not only a case of reducing the number of vessels, it's a question of the catching power. So sometimes you reduce the number of vessels, but the vessels that remain increase their catching capacity by having bigger engines, bigger nets, and so on. I mean, the Commission does publish figures on this, but whether they're very accurate, I don't know.
Yeah, well, my focus is where the reduction in catching power took place, and the feeling is that it very much took place in the UK fishing fleet rather than elsewhere. I mean, I don't know if anybody else in there can comment.
Come back, and then I maybe bring Bertie in, and then Stuart wants to, I think. Robin, do you want to say anything?
Targeted very much at Spain and Portugal, but whether it's been very effective in relation to those two countries, I don't know. As I say, I haven't seen any recent figures.
Before I do, Bertie, Calum indicated, and then if I may come to you, Calum.
It was just to provide a little bit of broader ecological context for this to emphasise that, you know, around 100 stocks are fished by UK, including Scottish boats, and by other nations. So obviously it's very complex. And, you know, the other side of the ecological equation, if you like, of the fish, a lot of the fish coming here, a lot of the fish that come into the EEZ waters around Scotland, as we heard this morning, such as mackerel, are spawning in the waters of other EU countries. So that's, again, just to emphasise that ecosystem approach, not to be just thinking about where the fish are to be caught, but where they spawn. And that's where that cross-border collaboration in whatever structure we have is absolutely key.
So global management is important. Sorry, do you want to come back on that, Bertie, maybe on who suffered the pain? I know where you're going.
Well, I think it was. There were certainly a great deal of sacrifices made here. And Robin's right about the equivalence of boat numbers is sometimes highly misleading. There requires to be some spare capacity. For instance, for the highly migratory species, which there are not many that behave in the way that Callum has just described. A lot of them are much more localized than that. But in order to catch mackerel on their migration out in the Northeast Atlantic, you need a big boat if you're not to kill yourself. And you need catching capacity because we have a big quota in normal terms. So therefore, as long as it's profitable, a bit of overcapacity is not necessarily a bad thing, provided the regulatory regime takes charge of it. And here's the vital central point, that the fishermen understand that sustainability is in their best interests. And although they could catch more, they do not do so for two reasons. One, so that the market holds up, and two, so that they don't engage in a downward spiral to hell in a handcart.
Stuart, do you want to come in, and then maybe we'll move on to the second theme that I'd like to look at?
I was just going to make a fairly brief historical point that even predates Bertie being at the SFF, that in the early 2000s, when there was a substantial decommissioning of the Scottish fleet, there was a huge amount of ill will created at that time because the EU were simultaneously providing funding to the Spaniards to increase the size of their fleet. And to this very day, even though we've moved to a rather different environment, that influences the thinking of many of the people involved in the catching sector, because the gross and demonstrable inequity of that essentially EU-driven intervention, on the one hand, quote, killing our fleet, and on the other hand, building up the Spaniards, is still something that you will not escape getting a reference to in many conversations with fishermen in my area of the country.
Okay, so I think we maybe leave that one there on the note that it hasn't all been perfect under the EU. Peter is going to talk about, would like to probe a little bit on this policy of how to untangle domestic policy from EU legislation.
Yeah, thanks, Edward. We all know, we've all discovered that fisheries policy is a very complex area, which possibly cannot be solved in its entirety by the Great Repeal Bill, which is, you know, about taking all laws from back into our hands in the UK. So, I mean, my question is, will a Great Repeal Bill work for fisheries and aquaculture? And do the experts have any particular concerns about a Great Repeal Bill in this region?
Who'd like to go on that? I'd quite like to bring in some of the aquaculture interests at some stage. So I sort of give you a warning that I'd like to just push on that. Maybe I'll start with Bertie again on that, just so.
That's a more than relevant question. If the Great Repeal Bill, the whole of the CFP, is embraced in UK law, then it frankly won't work, because relative stability and the grand disadvantage will be perpetuated. There are, we've already discussed this with the relevant people in UK government, and there are some, I'm delighted to say a term has arisen, which is inoperabilities. If you just did that, then it would be inoperable for a number of reasons. There's much that can be embraced. We've gone through the Common Fisheries Policy with a pen and lined out the bits that are inoperable. Much of it is operable, or some of it is operable, providing you take those big bits out. But there may need to be some new legislation, which, of course, is a bit of an uphill battle. There may need to be some new legislation for day one of Brexit. But we would see that as doable, we hope.
Scott, having given you warning, I mean, obviously you're a very important, and your industry is an important part of fish production for Scotland and the UK. Perhaps you'd like to say something about what your views on that
are. Well, specifically with the Great Repeal Bill, our concern would be regulatory equivalence. That would be important to us. Our major competitor being Norway, who are in the EEA, and they have regulatory equivalence with the EU, and we expect something similar once the Great Repeal Bill is enacted, and I know the Cabinet Secretary here has expressed similar sentiments, and we don't really have any issue with that. I mean, we live with the environmental regulation we have now. Occasionally we may think it may be over precautionary. I'm sure Callum would have an alternative opinion to that, but nevertheless it is world-class standards that we are all seeking, and I think that's what we've established. So we don't see any dividend coming from repealing regulation. We just don't envisage that at all. Our main concern really is more commercial than anything.
Okay, just on that, just, I mean, on the basis that a lot of operators in Scotland also operate in Norway, presumably the standards would be fairly interchangeable. Is that an unfair assumption?
Well, interchangeable is maybe not the right word. I mean, we operate to a code of good practice that's 540 compliance points within it, which really is the framework for how we operate and how we farm. And although there's, if you like, as I said, regulatory equivalents, there's a different interpretation in Norway to and the way environmental regulation is enacted in Norway is somewhat different to how it is here. So, you know, there are some parts of that model we would quite like. There are parts probably of ours that they would quite like. But the overall framework is set by the EU, and we both operate within that framework. So there are some differences. Equally, some of the differences arise on account of geography. I mean, the coastline of Norway is quite considerably different to the coastline of Scotland.
Sorry, just is it easier or less regulations in Norway to Scotland, or are they the same?
That's maybe too simplistic. In some instances, it could be regarded as more favourable with regard to incentivising different behaviours, I would say, in Norway, and that's something that we're in continuous conversation with Marine Scotland about.
Okay, John, you wanted to come in, and then Stuart.
What exactly do you mean by regulatory equivalence? Because that's not a term I'm afraid I'm very familiar with.
Well, basically, the regulatory framework we currently enjoy is really comes from, has its origins in the European Union. And the regulation that SEPA basically deploy in Scotland is based upon the environmental standards that are established in the European Union. And we have what we call EQS, environmental quality standards, which are invoked here to ensure that there's protection for the local environment and also the wide national environment. And we obviously have to abide by them, and we respect that, and we're relatively comfortable with that just now, and we don't envisage that changing significantly once the Great Repeal Bill comes in.
Calum, did you want to come in, and then I'd like to bring Stuart in.
Again, I would focus on any particular... legislative solution. The important thing is that in line with both Scottish Government and UK Government ambitions to be world leaders, and in line with the global management we were talking about, we'd like to see legislation strengthened and even going beyond. And I've touched on some of the things we wouldn't want to see lost that are the best of the CFP, but there's also very good global standards in terms of World Summit and Sustainable Development, the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea, OSPAR, the Northeast Atlantic Fisheries Commission, all these global drivers have to be taken into account. And the other key legal protections that are important are those that are delivered by directives such as the Marine Strategy Framework Directive, within which sustainable fisheries management would contribute, and the Birds and Habitats Directive, world-leading protection for important marine areas for species and habitats. So it's absolutely key, whatever the constitutional legal outcome is, that all these protections are strengthened and improved in order to meet ambitions of all four nations.
Stuart, do you want to come in? And then I'd like to bring in Alistair.
Just a couple of things fairly briefly. On salmon farming, I think just environmentally, given that Norway has very little tidal rise and fall, the environmental opportunity for the tide to disperse waste material from farming is much less in Norway than in Scotland. Now, I make no comment about that, apart from saying, therefore, clearly you need a different regulatory regime simply because of that physical difference in the locations, just to choose but one example of the differences. So I don't think the same regulatory regime would work in the two jurisdictions. But let me just move on to the real reason I put my finger up, which was looking at
domestic policy following great reform, I think we mustn't overlook the fact that we've also got to address the issue of domestic practice. And what I'm specifically concerned about is that I think the way in which we have to run enforcement will be different. We might need another fishery protection vessel, because I think our enforcement response, I can see, you know, I don't know the answer to that. I just say in the debate, we've got to address that issue, because it's not just about changing the law, it's about changing what we do as well. And our two fishery protection vessels are spread pretty thin. And if we've got more vessels out there, of our vessels out there, we're going to have a different enforcement regime we need to address. No answers, only a question.
Mm-hmm. And maybe the technology that's coming on stream will make that easier. But Alistair, you wanted to come in?
Yeah, well, I'm here today representing creel and dive fishing operations around the coastline of Scotland. And on the west coast in particular, where many of the rural communities rely on their catches to provide the rural communities with benefits that flow through the community. Our biggest concern is not really Europe, because we have exclusive access out to 6 miles, and most of our membership works within that 6 mile area. And the biggest darkness on our doorstep at the current time is the salmon farming industry, which are using copious amounts of chemical pollutants to treat sea lice. And those chemicals are responsible for reducing crustacea to form shell. We have to seek guarantees from the Scottish Salmon Producers Organisation that they clean up their act.
I'm going to try and defuse this slightly and just say that I understand your concerns, and I understand that there'll be concerns on both sides. And maybe this is something that we can look at beyond Brexit and the European Union, and it's something that Scotland needs to look at. Mike, can I bring you in? I take your point, though.
I'd like to particularly ask Scott this about regulatory regimes. When we come out of the European Union, and contrary to the view just expressed by Stuart, I would imagine, correct me if I'm wrong, I imagine for your exports to the European Union, you would need to have the same regulatory standards that the rest of the European Union operate within, in other words, to keep market share and perhaps increase market share over there?
Yeah, I think that was the point I was trying to make earlier on, is that the overall environmental regulatory framework, we operate under similar regimes. The interpretation is different. SEPA interprets it in a different way to the way the authorities in Norway do, and Stuart was right that obviously they have less tidal exchange in, off the Norwegian coast, but they have much deeper coastline than we have as well. So that's to their advantage with regard to sedimentary control. So, you know, we're not comparing apples with apples, as it were, as with oranges with regard to the different environment we operate in. Having said that, the overall or overarching environmental regulatory framework comes from the European Union. And
is that a similar standard?
Yeah. I mean, we want to be, like Calum mentions, world-class standards. We want to be world-class. Yeah. I mean, that we export to 65 countries around the world. We can't do that if we're not world-class standards in our production. Okay.
Thank you.
Michael, I'm wondering if you want to come in at all on keeping the standards the same as Europe and that. I mean, I can bring Peter in first. Sorry, I'm rather bouncing you for an answer. So maybe Peter come in first, and then I could maybe come back to you on that.
Well,
I mean,
I've got a specific question, convener. It's in this theme, and one of the themes that the industry is struggling with at the moment is the landing obligation issue, and that falls in here as well. And we know that there are issues. Nobody wants to see good fish go over the side, but there are issues with the tied in with quota and choke species and all that stuff. And I wonder if we're designing a new regime post Brexit, how that particular issue could be framed in a more suitable manner for our fishing community to live with.
Peter, you're not going to enjoy me for this. I'm going to hold that over to theme five, which I think is what elements of EU policy would you like to go? Because I think that the very issue of throwing dead fish over the side has been a very difficult thing, and I'd like to develop that under theme five, and I'll certainly bring you in with the same question.
Okay.
Michael, did you have a comment you wanted to make about trying to keep the integration with Europe and the produce going to Europe?
Yeah, thank you, Edward. We are
very similar minded to the salmon industry, that the standards that we have are needed to be maintained because of our successful export industry as well. We have many standards within the country here. We have salsa, BRC, and those standards are recognised throughout Europe, and a lot of people in Europe are asking for suppliers to have those standards in place. So we would, again, continue with those standards and, if possible, welcome any changes to it. But we're meeting a lot of what is going in place already, and we don't have any issues with the compliance of it. Our issue would be that, again, interpretation of the standards is different in Europe than it is here, but we interpret it the way that our country wants it to be interpreted, and it meets the standards required abroad. So again, we are successful in exporting our fish because of the way that we handle it and look after it.
Okay, John, you wanted to come in.
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, it was to pick up a point that Mr. Sinclair said that I know you wish to move on from. We are talking about the Great Repeal Bill.
Yeah.
But of course, there's the potential there for replacement. And I wonder if Mr. Sinclair saw that an opportunity with the Great Repeal Bill to put some more robust laws in place, because a lot of people share the concerns that you articulated there.
I have to, because we're at the stage now where there are things appearing in the press that are really questionable as to the behaviour of SEPA and others. And the communities from where our fishermen operate are seeing, for example, fish farm applications to be placed within marine protected areas. Well, that makes a nonsense of a marine protected areas. And they don't want to see marine protected areas spoiled in such a manner. Because we have anecdotal and there is other genuine proof that some of the chemicals that these guys have been using in the past are detrimental to the sea floor, and anything that's on the sea floor is going to be affected by chemical, and that in turn will affect the guys that are out there fishing for crustacea, etc. We have enough problems with microbeads and etc. etc. without getting into the problems that the salmon farming industry might place upon us.
Okay, sorry. Just before I bring you in, could I ask Calum to come in? And then I'll give you a chance to come back, and maybe then we can move on to the next subject. Calum, sorry.
Yeah, a small point in response to John, taking the point that MPA fisheries and MPA compliance might come under a future theme, but relevant to this theme, it was to emphasise that there's a commitment in the programme of government to an inshore fisheries bill, and the inshore is still to be defined, whether that's 6 or 12 or what have you, so there may be overlap with CFP or CFP2 or what have you. But it's just to take the opportunity to emphasise that regardless of how we in Scotland and across the UK choose to manage fishing, particularly in those offshore waters, that we can't let that opportunity to improve the inshore management through the inshore fishing bill be lost, because inshore fishing has been a bit of a Cinderella, it seems to me, in terms of sustainability and an overlooked area. So we welcome that bill coming forward.
I'm going to let Scott say a final comment before we move perhaps on to the next thing.
Thank you, Edward. I take your point, John Finney, that we're here to talk about the Great Repeal Bill at this point and then other aspects of Brexit. I didn't expect the salmon farming industry to be attacked when I got here this morning. And I think some of the references to recent media comments are potentially inflammatory, because some of that really, I feel, has been written in a manner as if we're hiding something. All of the data that's come out in the media recently is published. It's actually in the public domain, and we're complying with SEPA regulation. Now, if people want that changed, fair enough. Let's go through a proper lobbying process and discussion about that. But let's not just hang salmon farming in the court of public opinion, which is primarily being hijacked by campaigners.
Scott, I don't think salmon farming is being attacked. I think what's interesting between this session is we're talking, or this particular theme, is that we're talking on whether it's possible to untangle legislation. And what I think the committee is hearing is there's an first of all, there should be no reining back on the standards that are being set by Europe if we're still to be able to maintain within Europe. And there is a real opportunity to move the standards forward. That is my understanding of what's been said, and certainly what we've heard from the Scottish Fishermen's Federation is that it's not beyond the wit of man with negotiation to make this work. And I think that's where I'd like to leave this, and I would urge people that actually what we are trying to do is see a way forward and improving everything that we can, and I think that's important. So we said when, in fact, I stopped radar, I think we were talking about access to UK waters and quotas. And Rhoda, would you like just to rephrase your question, to bring it in now, about what will happen? Is it going to be a free-for-all?
I guess my question was slightly going on the first theme and on that theme, in that what is in the common fisheries policy that we would want to retain, and what, by coming out of it, where are the freedoms in that? And then leading on from that, how do we police that? Because how much of it is impacted by the common fisheries policy and how much not?
Okay, so does Bertie wants to come in? And I'd ask perhaps if we can think about this whole thing of access to the waters, not only the 0 to 12 miles, but the 12 miles to 200 miles, because I think that's important. But certainly everyone can come in if I can get you all in. Bertie, you want to start, and I'll keep my eyes in. Mike wants to come in as well. So, but
if I may say, Rona has just put her finger on the centre of the whole thing. The thing that's changed, that will change on Brexit, is governance of the exclusive economic zone. Radically and wildly into the model already adopted around the world for coastal states, capital letters with a specific meaning that you have their rights and responsibilities, from our present shared access, common grazing, we've been dismissing it as. That's the big bit. So it's a completely relevant question about what about access? Well, the answer to that is access to those waters is in the gift of the coastal state, much as Norway, Iceland, Faroes do that. So it would be up to the coastal state to decide who came in. The setting of opportunity is absolutely central to this, because how much fish can be caught, where and by whom, is the centre of sustainability. It either works or it doesn't. There already is, and I'm delighted to say, and it didn't quite come out in the seminar for those who attended it this morning, there already is a template for that known as coastal states, capital letters, where the relevant coastal states with fish in their EEZs get together and thrash out how much of what can be caught where. It's a well-trodden path. It is much less politicised than the common fisheries policy, because there's a cage in the common fisheries policy with all the EU fishing nations in it, and they try and influence what the individual negotiator will then do in coastal states. It's much more direct, taking Norway as an example, where they negotiate simply on their own behalf. They have, to use a phrase that you've heard before, have a seat at the top table, and that would be us. And who was in that seat would depend very much on what species. It would be a different set of people, typically Marine Scotland officials, if you were talking about mackerel or herring, the grand migratory species. If you want to talk about channel cod, there is no coastal state arrangement for that, but there'd have to be. And I would imagine it would be DEFRA officials, and we wouldn't care as long as no Scottish fish was swapped for channel cod. But that's another story. So there is a process out there where the principle of sovereignty, rights and responsibilities for the coastal state undertaken by us, and for us to then at last be able to negotiate for advantage of the coastal state the same way as everybody else does.
Mike, you wanted to make a comment.
On this very issue, common fisheries policy and international law, at the seminar this morning, it came as a surprise to me, having looked at this for years, it came as a surprise to me this morning, that we were told one quarter are within the Scottish exclusive economic zone of the UK's zone, one quarter of the fish in both quantity and value, are fished by the EU states, other than the UK. and one quarter are fished by non-EU states. So, well, I was under the impression that if we came out of the European Union and we'd be in charge of our own affairs, at the seminar this morning, it came to me, if I've interpreted it correctly, this is why I'm asking the question, that actually there are other obligations under international law that we have to adhere to. So is it, what my question is framed basically is it a fallacy that when we come out of the European Union, all this EU fishing capacity will be freed up for British and Scottish vessels? That's the key issue as far as I can see.
Let Bertie come in, but briefly, if I may, because I'd like to bring Robin in and in due course, Calum. So.
Robin will, without a shadow of doubt, explain this lucidly, but the answer to that is yes. The non-EU fishing that happens, an amount of fish is given to Norway, let's use Norway as an example, an amount of fish is given to Norway at the end of the EU-Norway agreements in exchange for other fish. Our problem in Scotland is that we are a big net contributor to the tune of 110,000 tons of blue whiting into this swap, which Norway receives gratefully and catches. And then you get a load of stuff back, which goes, none of it to Scotland, most of it elsewhere. So that inequity and disadvantage would be fixed at a stroke. There may well be still 25% of the fish taken from European from our waters fished in non-EU hands, but we'd get a much better deal than we presently get. The central point is that sovereignty and control would fall to the coastal state. You can make arrangements on that basis. And so the very short answer is yes.
A short answer, Bertie. And sorry, Robin, if I could bring you in, and then if I could bring in Stuart.
Thank you. If I might just add one or two little amplifications and qualifications on what Bertie has said. The basic starting position in international law is that a coastal state has sovereign rights over the living resources of its EEZ. The coastal state is not obliged to admit any other state to fish for those resources unless there is a surplus. In other words, if the allowable catch is greater than the fish catching capacity of the coastal state, then the Law of the Sea Convention says that other states must be given access to the surplus. But even after that, the coastal state has a complete discretion as to which states are given access, with the exception of landlocked and geographically disadvantaged states, but that's not relevant in the UK context. However, there are two or three things which mean I think that that strict principle won't necessarily apply. The first is that most of the stocks in the North Sea are shared stocks. That is to say that they, at the moment, they're shared between the EU and Norway. Post-Brexit, we would then need some trilateral arrangement, EU, UK and Norway. And then a lot depends on negotiation about allocation and swaps and so on that Bertie's mentioned. I would say just one thing about allocation, and that is that The Guardian a few weeks ago published what was described as a leaked paper from the European Parliament, where the European Parliament was saying that the principle of relative stability, which is what applies, is the allocation key at the moment, should continue post-Brexit. And that seems to me to be unacceptable. The EU has said very strongly in recent weeks that the UK, if it comes out of the EU, cannot enjoy the benefits of membership. And it seems to me that principle cuts both ways, so that EU states and fishing states cannot enjoy the benefits that they have at the moment under the EU. And the basic principle of allocation in the North Sea between Norway and the UK is a principle known as zonal attachment, which is that it's the proportion of the catch, the proportion of mature fish in each party's zone, which determines, broadly speaking, the division of the quota. So I think we should strongly hold out for that principle and resist any attempt to continue relative stability. I've gone on rather at length, but just one other brief point to bear in mind, and that is that the EU in the past has when negotiating trade arrangements, had a trade-off between greater access to the EU market and greater access for EU vessels to fishing grounds. This happened with Norway, where there is no free trade in fish in principle under the European Economic Area. But Norway was given greater access to the EU market. But in return, Norway had to give the EU greater access for EU vessels to its waters. So, you know, I think we need to be aware in the negotiations that will be taking place that the EU may try to play this card.
Of course, and I think the point was made at the briefing this morning that giving access doesn't mean you're necessarily going to catch more fish. It's giving access to the areas where there are fish. Stuart, do you want us to come in?
Thank you very much. Robin has rather helpfully answered many of the questions I was going to ask, but I have one residual little question. And that simply is whether it, and I'm not sure it's covered by any other heading in our proposed scheme of discussion, just whether it would be perfectly legal for us to abolish the existing quotas and replace them. I'm not proposing this, I hasten to add, before the price is put on my head, but whether it would be perfectly legal for us to do that and replace it with a different way of controlling, managing and allocating access rights. And I think I'm probably directing that just back to Rob.
If you want to put your head in the firing line on quotas,
Well, yes, very briefly. The UK will be responsible for management of the 200-mile zone. If it wants to operate with total allowable catches and quotas, it could do that. But if it wanted to replace it with a form of effort limitation, you know, so many vessels can fish in these areas at such times. I mean, that's also a possibility. So we would have a free choice, in other words, as to the type of management measure we adopted.
Well, Callum, do you want to come in on that, Bertie? I've logged it, but I want to try and work around the table. Callum, do you want to come in on that?
I mean, to respond to the question that Rhoda put about what to want to retain and what the freedoms, I think to consolidate what I was saying earlier, we'd like to retain commitment to an ecosystem-based approach to management, including appropriate measures to address discards. There needs to be a precautionary approach hardwired in there. I would wish to retain deep sea regulations, the principles enshrined by Article 17 in terms of, and this relates to the point about effective monitoring and management and so on, transparent objectives for environment, social and economic criteria, with integration with these overarching frameworks, Marine Strategy Framework Directive, Habitat Sports Directives, and retain a regionalised eco-region approach to management. As I mentioned, lots of straddling stocks and collaborations necessary. we have the freedom to improve. So there's in the Northeast Atlantic Fisheries Commission, United Nations Convention on the Sea, the UN Fish Stock Agreement. It's the EU that's party to those. So in the absence of the CFP, it's not a free for all. So there needs to be a sensible sort of four nation approach to negotiating with all those international frameworks to get sustainable ecosystem-based outcomes. A big part of the improvement I think that's needed is effective spatial measures, not just in relation to MPAs and SACs, but in terms of protecting important critical fish habitat for spawning grounds, for example, and breeding grounds. And the in terms of that wider context, the Marine Atlas you know, does highlight the concerns about wider ecosystem health. So we shouldn't just focus on stocks. So there's a lot of concerns about wider seabed and ecosystem health the improvement to spatial management of fishing could also help to address in addition to, you know, improved stock management and these other measures. And improved management can come about through full documentation, which is maybe something that we can get onto later.
Filling your shopping basket of things that you're asking for may be overflowing.
Okay.
I could go to Bertie and just ask him to make a comment on that. And then I'd like to just come back to creeling and what I would like to just to prompt you on, Alistair, is if you see any threats from other boats from other countries to creeling in Scottish waters. But maybe you can answer that very quickly, Bertie.
Callum's shopping list and Robin's small diversion into potential management measures. There's no reason in God's earth why all of this can't be embraced with alacrity. The good bits of the CFP, focus on sustainability and the freedom to use any method. I'll have to say an effort management only one is something of an untried system. We're unlikely to go straight to that. But all this is entirely possible because once we're out of the cage of the CFP, we can do all of this and better. And we start from a good position because we're entirely compliant right now with everything, and we can move forward from there.
Alistair, do you see any threats to Creelers from coming away from Europe?
I really don't think so. It would be too far to travel to make it viable.
So there's no, from your industry's point of view?
I don't think we have any great concerns there. We have vessels that come from Guernsey, super crabbers, etc., that come and take lobster and brown crab from stock. And they don't have any real impact on local fisheries. They might have in discrete areas, but the discrete areas where these vessels fish are generally areas where the smaller boat can't fish, further out to sea.
Okay, well, if everyone's happy with that, I may move on to the next theme, which is access to funding, expertise, labour and resources. And I think Finney was going to lead us off with a question on that.
Indeed. Thank you, Convener. And it was with reference to the European Maritime and Fisheries Fund and the sum of money that comes to Scotland to support sustainable fishing and help coastal communities. And that's 44% of the UK fund. This may be particularly important for the fish processing sector. So the question is, will the UK and Scotland lose access to funding, expertise and resources that are particularly important for fisheries and aquaculture? And its scientific expertise is perhaps one that I'd be keen to understand.
It's a very good question. But can I just say that I would like to hear from Michael and Scott on that, because I think it will affect your industry as well. But if we start with Bertie and work that way, and then I'll work up this way.
For the catching sector, it's quite simple. The amount of funding we receive from the EMFF is approximately, now Ian will put me right and shout if this is wrong, it's about 1%. Of first sale and landing. We are not an industry that depends on subsidies at all. In fact, it would be a distortion if we were. When there's a fund available, you grab it. And we do with some enthusiasm. If it's not there, it's not going to kill us, and we do not wish to develop into an industry that depends on funding. So the last point, the very short point to make, is that is the UK as a net funder, all things being equal, and I know life is more complicated than this, if we give in more than we get, then surely it is not beyond the wit of man to support everything that is supported by funds, if those arguments stand up by themselves.
I think, Bertie, John, part of John's question was also to do with labour. That right?
I haven't come on to that. But of course, an important element of the present situation is the free movement of labour. It's something that's very important to people, and the implications of any alteration to that situation we'd like to hear. Thank you.
Without a doubt, and Michael, of course, will speak for the processing industry, there is some EU labour in the catching sector. Not a lot, to be honest. I'm seized with this thought. What country would not supply itself with labour that it requires? There's a difference between free movement of all Europeans under the, one of the four freedoms in the single market, and a country like the UK allowing people in to do jobs that it wants people to do. I can't see that this is an unjumpable hurdle.
Murray, before we move on, you indicated you want to add something to this.
Well, that was actually going to be my specific question, was related to the free movement of labour and exactly how important that is, because I take your point, you see it's not a hurdle, but I think we've talked about that in some other areas and some other debates, that fair enough, we have a labour force here and a section of that could be working, but obviously it's depends where you are in the country. It's not all concentrated in one place, and it is just really the impact of the free movement of people. And I imagine that will be, from the processing side, that will have a big impact.
Michael, would you like to talk on that?
Yes. Thank you, Edward. Certainly, our sector relies heavily on nationals from other EU countries, and there's no question that we couldn't survive without them. Our own workforce no longer sees the fish processing sector as a viable, lucrative area to work in, since
basically since oil came on board and started pushing up wages and pinching, you know, workers, and it became a more attractive industry to go to. So we would certainly like all foreign workers, for want of a better description, that are currently working in the country to be allowed to stay here. And we rely on that quite heavily, because I can't see how we are going to be able to change the perception of youngsters that our industry is a career industry and is worth coming into without being able to offer huge wages to compete with other industries. So we really need these people to stay here and to be able to come here and add to it as our sector will grow. You know, there's a lot of businesses keen to expand just now, but the uncertainty of Brexit is holding back investment. And once the uncertainty becomes clearer and everybody knows what we're faced with and how we're going to progress, there'll be a lot of companies ready to invest in the future, but they'll need staff.
I think Murray wants to just come back and develop that a wee bit.
Point, really, that'll be quick. And it was really just to, do you have a figure on a percentage of how much your the workforce across processing is, you know, comes from how many EU migrants you have in the industry as a whole?
Difficult to give you a figure, but if I take the companies I know of in the northeast, which are obviously predominantly Aberdeen and Peterhead, you're finding in most companies as little as 20% are home staff, you know, local people. There's a huge majority of EU nationals working in our industry, certainly over 60%, mm-hmm. well Excellent. Over.
But before we move on to Scott, I think Stuart had a question just on that.
Just a wee financial one for the processing industry. With the current limit of €30,000 support over, I think, 3 years. I never quite remember. Yeah, 3 years. Essentially, the processing industry is not a big recipient either, as the catching industry, of European funds. The European Maritime and Fisheries Fund is essentially an infrastructure fund that supports communities and is usefully, I would suggest, supporting harbours in their wider exploitation of opportunities, not just in fishing. So perhaps I'm correct, I hope, in saying that the processing industry is similarly pretty detached from EU financial support.
Yes, Stuart, unfortunately, you're correct. We are very detached from it, yeah.
Scott, do you want to come in and tell us a little bit about what your industry?
Thanks very much. I think just to reiterate what Stuart said, aquaculture is similar to what Bertie said and Michael. We don't enjoy a lot of EMFF support. We do apply for match funding for one or two things from time to time, but it doesn't run to tens of millions. It runs to maybe one or two per annum, which is good. I mean, it's not to be sniffed at, but it's not significant, and it's not crucial to our future well-being as an industry. So it's something that I wouldn't put up as a red line issue, if you like, for us in the future. Nevertheless, you know, it's always helpful. We do have a lot of money going into from the higher education funding into innovation centres, which the Scottish Government established a few years ago, and we are looking forward to some dividend from that in the near future. So, and I think we'll see some significant change in our management of the welfare of our fish through that, and that's really the main purpose for it being established. So it'll take time, but we're definitely making progress in that score. So I think that maybe will help one or two frustrations, if you like, that we've heard today with regard to salmon farming. Just on the point of EU migrant labour, we estimate that in our primary and secondary production for salmon, and as you can imagine, farmed salmon is the one guaranteed fish that goes into the processing plants every day. And that was a point made at an SNP conference a couple of years ago by a delegate. That's the fish that does happen to arrive every day in a processing plant. And we reckon it's about 8,000 people from the EU
involved in processing.
Proportion of your overall?
Well, I mean, I can't speak for the processing sector, but as far as farming is concerned, we're not a labour-intensive industry. We employ about 2,500 people.
Sorry, just to develop that, can you give a percentage of those 2,500 people?
Very small, like 10%.
Sorry, John, you wanted to
come
back.
It was just one point, and maybe the contributors are going to come to it, but I also asked about the potential loss of scientific expertise. A lot of academia shares experience. I mean, it's the same water. It's what we've heard in the forestry industry about shared expertise. Is there any concerns that the panel have about loss of scientific expertise?
Maybe Calum could come in on that, and I don't know, Robin, do you have a view, but Calum, maybe you could just come on scientific experience. Do you think that's going to be a loss?
I'm not closest enough to the funding structures, but obviously I can speak to the principle of that there needs to be adequate resources to support sound science, because all this ecosystem-based management of fisheries stocks and wider management decisions, including on aquaculture, needs to be based on good science, but also the precautionary principle applies when data is lacking. I mean, I would like to say something about the incentives as well in relation to the actual fleet very quickly. And it's important, whatever the sort of EMF equivalence is, it's allocated according to need, and that these incentives encourage sustainable practice, so we get a race to the top, so that we're encouraging improved gear selectivity. Again, things I'm sure everybody around the room can agree with, and that can lead, encourage improved spatial management as well in terms of temporal and other spatial areas. So we need to have financial incentives for the industry to encourage the sustainable practice we want to see, that will then, which is good business sense as well, because you then have a more sustainable product, which is higher value, conceivably lower environmental impact, or ideally lower environmental impact, and that is the sort of market, the sort of vision Scotland would want to project to the market, domestically and globally, I'm sure. And resources are also important for monitoring and compliance, of course.
I'm assuming if any of the panel members aren't looking at me, they definitely don't want to come in, and I will have to force them to come in. I think, Scott, you want to come back, and I would like to ask Alistair just a wee bit about resources and labour as far as EU and Creel fishermen are concerned. Sorry, Scott.
Thank you, Katrina. I don't have the figures, but it's a good question from John, and I think we need to be aware that there's a lot of higher education support coming from the EMFF in particular with regard to our industry, the Institute of Aquaculture at the University of Stirling, which is regarded as a world-class educational and research establishment in the world of aquaculture. And, I'm aware that they have some serious concerns regarding reduced funding.
Okay. Alistair, do you want, as far as creel fishermen concerned, grants from the EU or labour from the EU, is there a contribution or is there not?
There's no great appetite from within the creel industry to actually go out and seek funding from the EMFF, because the creel industry, like the mobile industry, is a here and now business. The boats can be repaired and sorted in a couple of days and bang, they're off to sea again. Yeah. And form filling is a very difficult thing to get creel fishermen to do. It's hard enough to get them to fill in their landing sheets on a weekly basis, never mind a long convoluted form for EMF funding.
Bertie, do you want to come back in on any of those?
The scientific support is exceedingly important. The International Council for the Exploration of the Seas, the recognised international body, a lot of data leaves us, and there's great assistance from the EU for that data to be provided. That needs to be replaced. Along the same lines, there's money there to do that, but that needs to be thought of. We cannot possibly have a degradation of stock assessments as a result of anything we do.
John, do you want to follow any of that?
Thank you very much.
Okay. If everyone's happy, we may move on to that theme. And the next one is on what elements of the EU policy members of the panel are keen to see go.
I think Jamie's got a specific question, and Calum was very adept at filling up a shopping basket. If I, it helps the committee if you can focus on a couple of issues, if that's what Jamie's going to ask you. But Jamie, perhaps you could lead off.
Thank you, Convener. I think you've just asked the question for me.
Sorry. That's but, me put in my place, and you'll never get another question.
But if
question,
I may, just for the benefit of being on the camera, I'll say a few words. I think one, it's fascinating listening to this conversation. I've been quietly listening in the corner here, but I think there's generally seems to be consensus that there are elements of CFP that have been positive and beneficial. It's not all doom and gloom. I appreciate there are and have been many complexities and problems with it, but it's nice to hear that there are there is consensus among the general objectives around sustainability and ensuring that we have strong industries, but also ones that do take into account the needs of the coastal communities that participate in these industries. On the other side of that, however, I wonder if there is there any consensus around elements of the CFP that we would be happy to see the back of. Now, Robin mentioned relative stability. We've briefly touched on landing obligations, quotas, technical regulations, and so on. So I would generally like to hear if anyone has any views on things that the that this does present any opportunities at all in a post-CFP EU era.
Thank you, Jamie, for making the question your own. Robin.
Well, I think a lot of things will go simply through the UK leaving Brexit, leaving the EU and therefore leaving the common fisheries policy, and relative stability will be one of them. Historic access rights, which I don't think we mentioned really before, to the 12-mile zone, that will go, I'm sure. Otherwise, yes, you caught me rather on the hop on this. So I'll leave others who've got stronger views.
If we work back the way, maybe Scott, have you got anything, or do you want to? Okay, looks
don't really
like
make
we're
any
working
comment
around. Michael is looking the other way, so it's definitely Bertie.
Thank you very much. You may have heard the phrase "sea of opportunity," where we have been defining the opportunities that come from this, and Robin put his finger on it. It's the move away from relative stability and the gaining of sovereignty and governance in our world will produce a gigantic game-changing opportunity for the seafood industry of Scotland, indeed of the UK, where we can behave on the world stage in the same sort of way that, for example, Norway does. So there are a number of opportunities. And that increased economic volume, all other things flow from that. If you've got an increased activity, then the jobs can be made more attractive, you would hope, and our reputation would grow. So there's a stream of opportunity from additional economic activity which will fall our way unless it's deliberately traded away or this is handled badly.
Mari, did you have a follow-up to that?
Yeah, I did. Well, it was just about quota hopping and on the back of some of the questions that we had in the briefing this morning about quotas, and I thought that was developing into quite an interesting topic, and it was just to hear a bit more from Bertie in particular about quota hopping, since she responded to that this morning, and how much is that much of an issue in Scotland? Is that something that's prevalent here?
It certainly exists, and as Wendy,
Ken, is she still here?
As Wendy said this morning, it's not actually to do with fishing management. It's to do with the right of establishment of a brass plate and about the purchasing of companies. Land Rover is beneficially owned elsewhere, for instance. So you can do that. There would be an opportunity, should the governments of the land decide to change that, if you wish. Norway do it differently, as I mentioned this morning, from us. But it's not the central question. We're not having our industries bought over in Scotland to any great extent, but it's something that we could guard against, recognizing the underlying principle that everyone seems to support here and most other countries support, is that your national resource of fish is indeed a national resource and something that you do not completely privatize. Like, you know, it's not like buying steel for car making. It's different because it's a national resource, and we can strengthen that or loosen it as desired post Brexit. The unique opportunity exists post Brexit to do that in whatever way the government decides.
Stuart wants to come in. We're getting a queue of people now, so Stuart.
It's a relatively small point. It's back to the point I raised earlier about decision-making and policy-making, that I understand when the Norwegians are sitting down to negotiate with the EU, the fishermen are there as part of the delegation. In the EU, it's the politicians and the officials who are there, not the fishermen. And I wonder whether there is not an opportunity to have the people, A, who are affected by the decisions directly, as part of the negotiating team, but B, who also can inform officials and in particular politicians who are rarely experts in anything. Even if we come to Parliament as an expert, our expertise atrophies and disappears. And I just wonder whether looking at EU policy, that's a key area where we can draw more people with relevant knowledge and experience to the table and get better outcomes.
I'm just going to bring John in because I think there's a twofold question here, and then just because we're starting to stack up a wee bit.
Okay, thanks. I mean, it was based on what Bertie Armstrong just said. I mean, he paints the picture of, you know, we could just take all the powers back on board. I mean, I think the assumption is that the UK government's going to say, well, we want to get a special deal for the financial sector in London, so we'll give away part of the fishing because that doesn't really matter to the UK. So, I mean, within the EU policy, are there bits that you would want to keep and bits that you'd be more happy, you know, that you just accept that the UK will trade them away?
There's two separate questions there. One of the potential for the UK to trade it away. We will react as savagely as we can manage to anybody, any government of any colour, trading away what we regard as literally once in a generation opportunity to take charge of our own national resource. So that's really the central point of that. I'm hoping nobody's going to sell us anywhere.
I think we've got to be careful about talking about things that are being suggested
yes.
that aren't actually fact.
Yes.
And I think that what we've got to be careful of is to take cognizance of the fact that there is, I think, once in a generation was your expression, although I'm sure I've heard that before, about getting an opportunity of making a change, and you're not going to sacrifice that for anyone. So maybe we could leave that one there. The second part of that, Stuart, did you have a question? Your question was on the people at the table, sorry.
We've just been to Norway. In fact, I think DEFRA and Marine Scotland are, as we speak, with the officials in Norway. Stuart exactly describes the situation. Now, it's not the lunatics in charge of the asylum. It is the relevant subject matter experts talking to the right decision makers. And Norway warned us that there's rough and tumble in the room when this goes on. But it's, if you like, our rough and tumble. You're not one of eight trying to influence your politician who then tries to influence a negotiator who decides what he's going to do in the first place. So it's much closer. The relevant expertise is much closer to the decision making, and we would be pushing as hard as we can to be the relevant experts are part of the, including scientists, are part of the decision making process.
Calum, I'm happy to let you in with a small shopping basket, if that's
well,
okay.
I was going to say, I don't have a reverse shopping basket of things to remove at the minute, but if I could just comment from the CFP, but if I could just comment on some of the points Bertie made, not to disagree with them, but just to sort of elaborate very quickly, just absolutely support this idea that stocks are a national resource, can't privatise, and the example we heard this morning of mackerel absolutely exemplifies that, where they spawn off Ireland and are fished off Scotland. We heard about Norway. I'd also like to look at, draw the committee's attention to New Zealand and British Columbia and Canada, where they're very successfully using remote electronic monitoring. So that helps to improve fisheries management, and that could help in an area where there might be some grumbling around the CFP in terms of the discards ban. So there's a good report by WWF I could draw the committee's attention to look at improvements that could be made in monitoring activity of sea, at sea and catch in a socially just way.
Bring more rather than taking away. So I think I'm going to move on and ask okay. Peter to he had a point he'd like to make.
Just to get back to the landing obligation, I wonder if there's a better way we could manage that post-Brexit. And because we all want to see this work, but it has to be managed. It has to be sensible and work within the as it is just now, the quota system and the worry of choke species. So I just throw that out and see whether there's a better way we can do that.
Can I do it very briefly, because we're going to come on to catching and processing.
Absolute brevity. The problem with the CFP landing obligation is that it was politically driven without proper regard for the practical application. It's a bit like banning road accidents and sitting back, dusting your hands and saying it's all done. How would you do that? The Norwegians operate a discard ban, which is less worse than the UK one, and we might take that as a model. It must be done. We must stop this, or we must reduce this as far as physically possible. But the EU model right now is preposterously unworkable.
Okay, Alistair, do you want to come in?
If there's anything that we can retain from the CFP, we would like to see, probably Marine Scotland that would be in charge of all this, but we would like to see them look at Article 17, which clearly states that member states shall endeavour to provide incentives to fishing vessels deploying selective fishing gear or using fishing techniques with reduced environmental impact, such as reduced energy consumption or habitat damage. We have to have that in whatever we create.
Okay, I think Callum would support you on that, and I think fishermen would, from what I've been hearing as well. So I think that's interesting. The next theme is to do with coordination. I'm going to say no more in case I steal Richard's thunder. Richard.
Most of what I was going to ask actually already has been answered or suggested, but I'm old enough to remember the Cod Wars. I'm old enough to remember, the British Navy out and, facing other countries. So, and with the greatest respect, some of us feel that the Scottish fishing industry has had a bad deal for years and will still get a bad deal whatever Brexit comes out with. I was interested in a comment that Professor Robin Churchill said that as a coastal state, we just retain all fishing areas for ourselves. Should we, or do we have to, or do we want to coordinate domestic fishing policy with neighbours, or do we want to take it back to our own, within our own? And sorry I couldn't make this morning's meeting, but I know from previous meetings I've been on this committee in the last session that Scottish quotas have been bought up by foreign boats. And basically, that would be done away with once we get into Brexit. So do we want to coordinate with our neighbours, or do we want to keep all our fish, wherever it was spawned, do we want to keep all our fish for the Scottish fishing industry and for Scottish fishermen?
Robin, do you want to come on that?
I think the short answer to that is if we do not coordinate with the EU and Norway, there's a real risk that it'll be every state for itself and the fish will be overfished. Each state will just take it what it regards as its legitimate share, which probably will be larger. When you add the three together, will be more than 100% of what scientists are recommending as the total catch.
Okay, does anyone else want... Bertie, do you want...
That's absolutely correct. But in the briefest of statements, that will not be possible for all stocks. It will simply not be possible to take the volume of stocks. Other countries take the volume of stocks that they have under relative stability in their own waters. But a real and present danger, and of course we'd want to coordinate, yeah.
I mean, sorry, John, yeah. And then Richard, come back.
Yeah. Thank you, Pat. The other commentators would like to pick up on the point that Alistair made about the sustainable
issues and the retention of that particular section.
Okay. Do you build that into your answers? Richard, do you want to...
Yeah, I would really like to ask Mr. Armstrong, how strong does he feel, or how much of inclusiveness has the UK government and including your association or fishermen in general, wherever they are in the UK, in regards to what will happen after Brexit? Okay, yes, I understand we all have to negotiate. We can't go back to the Cod Wars. We can't go back to, the Navy hasn't got the ships now to go up and down the Channel or the North Sea or whatever. But how much inclusiveness is the UK government asking the Scottish Fishermen's Federation or the English Fishermen's Federation to be included in these negotiations?
We have had meetings with David Jones's department, with Andrea Leadsom twice, and we're meeting her again next week, with officials in DEFRA South, ad nauseum with officials North, and with those MSPs who bother themselves, most especially the Cabinet Secretary. So we are talking to everyone. We're not getting hard assurances from everybody that your outcome will be as follows, but on the other hand, we are not getting ignored, and as I said earlier, we will react as savagely as we possibly can to this opportunity not being taken. The figures are really stark. There's a zonal attachment paper, what fish live here and what proportion of them live here and what proportion do you catch. I pick out one example, herring. 88% of the herring basically live in our waters in the Northern Continental Shelf. That's a very general statistic. We get 15% of the TAC. So we'd like that to change. And there's a list of 17 in this study taken from the official figures where a grand long period of disadvantage needs to be settled. Of course, in coordination, but there must be a robust approach to this. You don't leave the golf club and continue to pay the fees. The point that Robin really made very well is that it cuts both ways. If we've left the control of the EU, we want some of this back.
Calum, did you want to maybe answer John's question on conservation? Did you want to say something there or not?
So I'd have to be reminded of that. Sorry, I was.
John, do you want to just remind?
Well, it's an issue that Alistair raised when asked about what would be worthy of retention, and it was about using sustainable methods and the low carbon impact that they would have. I'd hope to maybe hear from Mr. Armstrong on that because.
Well, perfect. Bertie, if you'd like to answer, and maybe you, Callum, will get a chance to gather your thoughts to come in with a short answer.
Gear development to use less fuel, to have less impact, and to catch less of that which you don't want to catch is a moving picture. We apply a lot of time, effort, and money to it, and I would see a redoubling of efforts to do that under our own management rather than a cessation of it.
I think there's... Caleb, do you want to come in briefly? Because I'd like to move on to the next theme, if I may, on...
Yeah, I mean, I think I answered earlier a lot of the things worth retaining, and definitely the approach articles 4 and 17 provide for ecosystem-based management and transparent objectives, the deep sea ecosystem regime as well. And just very briefly to answer Richard, as also said earlier, of course, we would support a regionalised eco-region management approach. We need to collaborate and... whilst not perfect, the advisory councils for the North Sea and Northwest Waters are a good start. So we need to collaborate, and for the reasons Robin said as well, to preserve straddling stocks.
Okay, maybe we can move on to the next theme, if we may, and it's to do with the product. So I'd ask Rhoda to lead on that one.
Yes, it's kind of coming away from... the common fisheries policy, but going into trade. A lot of our fish caught is sold to the EU, as well as a lot of our processed fish going to the EU. What impact is that going to have on us? What outcome would people want to make sure that it's fine having all the opportunity to fish, but if you don't have somewhere to sell it, then that becomes a huge difficulty for the industry. So how do we overcome that and how do we negotiate?
So maybe we could bring Michael in to start on that one, please.
Well, to answer Rhoda's question, where else can the EU get the fish from? You know, we're currently exporting quite a lot of our product to the EU because they need it. If we have a greater share of the raw material, that means there's a lesser share for the EU vessels to have, which would increase the demand for our product because they're catching less, but they're still consuming those same levels, so they will require that product. So we feel that you know, export sales and even domestic sales will continue and, if anything, will increase. We are not afraid of any changes to tariffs because, again, we feel that those will be minimised because of the demand for our product from EU. They just can't get it anywhere else. You know, where can they get fish from if not from our waters and from our processors if their access is reduced? I'm not saying it will, their access will stop, but it will certainly reduce, and they require that product. So we're quite confident that this is a good opportunity for the processing sector.
Rhoda, if you'd like to come back on that.
I just want to come back on that because obviously if there are tariffs in place, that increases the cost. I mean, how elastic is that going into kind of basic supply and demand economics? There must be a point where tariffs would actually affect people's buying power. So there must be, you know, is there a concern, or are you quite confident that no matter what they do within reason, and one imagines it would all be within reason, won't impact on sales?
Again, Rhoda, you're quite correct. There would be a limit, of course, to that, but our feeling is because of the demand for the product, that any increase in tariff would be as little as possible to avoid making the price of that raw material too high for them. Just because we have the product doesn't mean that we can demand any price for it, but the demand for it is so high and strong, very strong, it's very consistent throughout the whole year, that the level of increase we feel would be minimal, because they value the product. They don't want to put such a barrier in place to reduce or to increase the cost of it. They still want that product. So we feel that negotiations on tariff will be in our favour, so to speak, that whilst there will be an increase, it will be offset by the increase in demand for the product.
Now, there's a queue of people waiting to come in, and Alistair's been waiting the longest. So I'm going to do it in the order that you revealed your question. So Alistair first,
I have
and
then
to I'm
agree
going
to
come with, to Scott.
I have to agree with much of what Michael said. The demand is far outstripping the supply in our sector. It's probably the same situation with Michael. And I can't imagine Europe placing tariffs upon the product that we have, which is second to none on the planet, right? For the sake of giving UK a bloody nose. And they can't do that to our fishermen. And one of the most encouraging things that I've seen through my position as National Coordinator for the Scottish Creel Fishermen's Federation is that over the past 2 years, I've been receiving inquiries from as far away as China for the product that we're actually selling. And in recent times, they've actually developed a railway system that comes all the way from China to France. It takes 7 weeks, but nevertheless, they've developed this because they want product from Europe. Now, Scotland, okay, we've got the tunnel now, so we can get all the way to China now. So there's many benefits. coming our way, and it'd be extremely foolish of Europe to give us a bloody nose on that one.
I think there may be some locals that will miss their shellfish if they all disappear. But Scott, you want to come in?
Yeah, I mean, we've sort of worst case scenarioed this with regard to potentially there could be what's been described as a hard Brexit, clean Brexit, and we know now from the Prime Minister's statement that they're looking for a clean Brexit, and therefore on WTO tariff favoured nation status, we would be incurring a 2%. A tariff on fresh salmon, a 13% tariff on smoked salmon. And so putting that to one side, I then go and look at the significant fluctuations in the market prices we've had in the last 12 months. So in 2015 into the European Union, Scottish salmon attained £3.92 a kilo, and in 2016 attained £5.74 a kilo. That's a 46% rise in what we were attaining as market price. So that's a huge variation, a huge increase beneficial to us. And, you know, if you put it in that context, as the background context, the tariff is negligible. Whatever the tariff happens to become, it really is negligible. Our biggest challenge is actually producing enough to meet the demand. No matter we've got a major competitor a few hundred miles away across the North Sea, that is our biggest challenge. And I take on board Alistair's points about safeguarding other species, and you know, it's something that we're spending inordinate amounts of money and about to do a lot more to help in that situation. And so, you know, that's our big challenge. Our challenge I foresee in all of this is not about tariffs. It's actually about any potential physical impediments to moving perishable goods quickly to market. We can get fresh Scottish salmon on the white linen tablecloth in Manhattan within 24 hours of harvest. And we likewise can do that in the European Union as well. But that's on account of the very free movement, physical movement of the fish. So there are no barriers, paper barriers or, you know, whatever you want to call it, physical barriers at the marine ports or the airports. And that, to me, is the big challenge. It's not really the tariff.
I feel eyes boring into me from all directions. I will try and get round you all. Robin, you were next.
I understand perfectly the logic of what Michael is saying. I just feel that EU practice is not entirely on your side. It looks as though what we will end up with post-Brexit is a free trade agreement of some kind between the UK and the EU. Most free trade agreements that the EU has concluded with other states do not include free trade in fish or agricultural products. Even with Norway, tariffs are payable on imports of many fishery products from Norway into the EU. So I'm not convinced that the EU is going to necessarily give us a good deal on that. The other thing I think is, which is very important, is Scott's point about documentation, which is that if you export any kind of perishable goods to the EU, you have to comply with EU sanitary standards and have to have the documentation to show that you're complying. As far as the fish catching side is concerned, there'll be have to be documentation showing that the EU's rules of origin are being complied with as well. So I think from a trade point of view, a hard Brexit is a nightmare because it will, apart from the tariffs issue, it will increase enormously the amount of documentation required.
Stuart, do you want to come in at that stage?
I two things. The documentation one has now been covered, so I'll skip that. I just wanted to make the general point that probably in tariff terms, fluctuation in currency is a much bigger influence on the amount of money that the industry can make. And currently that's the bigger and more difficult to manage threat. So that was it, Camilla.
Scott, I
agree with you, Stuart. But the currency against the euro was, say, 12-15% movement, but 46, you know, that's a quarter of that. You know, it's the dynamics of the market really is the driver.
I was going to say, Scott, I'll come back to you in a minute, but you sort
pardon.
Of jumped the gun.
Sorry.
I'll let you away with it on this occasion because Alistair was waiting. Yeah. Alistair.
Robin actually alluded to it was the documentation and the hoops that we might have to jump through might be another way of getting us.
So documentation is proving a grave concern. Bertie.
Last little thought. We must not imagine that the single market or Europe is the only market in the world. 33 countries, 400 million people. Yep. Oh, there's another 178 of them out there with 7.5 billion people in it. When the Russian sanctions were applied and we lost the pelagic fish market, we were able in fairly short order to reset that fish to other markets and opened up a market in the Far East, which has been very good thus far. And to Africa for the lower quality, lower priced fish. Therefore, there is another world out there which will be opened to us, and we shouldn't forget that.
Okay. Michael, did you want to come in? I've sort of lost track. There were so many hands flying up and down.
Yes, thank you, Edward. My point was to latch on to something that Scott said, that there's, you know, a lot of our members are keen to expand their business to take advantage of increased orders, but are just holding back, obviously, because of the uncertainty of what's going to happen. But once everybody knows what we're faced with and all agreements have been reached, our sector's looking to move ahead and expand.
Jamie, you'd indicated you wanted to come in as
just
well.
Just an observation, really. I mean, the whole point of tariffs, taking it right back to the fundamental, you know, rationale behind them, surely originally was to stop importing produce competing with locally produced products. Therefore, tariffs would try and stabilise those markets. In the instances of salmon, for example, they were selling into countries which have neither the ability nor the desire to produce those products. So there's always going to be, and I'm really glad to hear that Bertie thinks there is a worldwide demand for our products outside of the EU single market. But I was really intrigued by Scott's point about it isn't just about tariffs, it's actually about more some of the more logistical barriers that might be in place that would prevent these markets flourish. So I think that's something maybe, you know, from a political point of view, it's worth bearing in mind that it's not just about contracts and financial tariffs. It's actually about the physical logistics, and that's something I certainly will take away from this meeting. Thank you.
Scott, you jumped the gun, but do you want to go back to something you were going to say earlier, or are you happy?
Yes.
Can I ask if there's any other... Calum, sorry, I know you wanted to come in.
Just a quick point. I appreciate this session is mainly about export, but just to take the opportunity to remember or emphasise the potential for shortening supply chains as well and keeping good high-quality produce and growing the markets for those within Scotland and the UK. As well, in terms of opportunities and things to incentivise, irrespective of constitutional arrangements.
John wants to come in, and Michael then wants to come in on the back.
It was just Callum's, there seems to be a bit of a contradiction with, certainly my position of supporting Alistair earlier about sustainable and then talking about transporting food halfway around the world. So I think it is about trying to maximise local production and consumption.
Okay. Michael, you wanted to come in.
Totally agree with the point that Callum made and backed up there by John, that this is an opportunity that could work in our favour to reduce the imports of fish, which would in turn increase the demand for local fish to be used throughout the country. It's ironic that we export 80% of what we catch and 80% of what we eat is imported. This would be an ideal opportunity to try and redress the balance to minimise imports, which would be offset by the increased availability of raw material from the catching sector, which the processing sector could handle. And for those that can't export, whether it's to Europe or wider afield, the opportunities to increase sales within the UK would be welcomed by all sectors.
Sorry,
could Michael give the value of these 280% if he has them?
No, I don't, Stuart. Sorry.
Okay. I'm going to come to Alistair, but we're coming to the end of this session, and I think it's fair to give the people who've been kind enough to give us evidence that there are two questions coming your way, so you might want to gather your thoughts to them while Alistair is giving his thoughts. And one is a very simple one, is to ask, are there any other implications for your sectors which you haven't had a chance to bring up during the course of this evidence session? And then a final point is to ask you for one point that needs to be done now to prepare for leaving for the EU. So those are the two questions in conclusion. I will ask other members around the table before we come to those if they've got questions they want to ask, but I'll ask Alistair to give a
I'd like to go back to John regarding the supply chain and how far your product travels. It was only a couple of years ago that we had Fish and Chip Shop of the Year awards, and Seafish, the body responsible for looking after the interests of the fishermen who prosecute their fishery in the North Sea, actually went abroad to pick up the fish for the purpose of the Scottish Fish Shop of the Year award.
Michael, I'll let you come back on that. I don't want it to be a
I went on Russia TV with that one.
Michael, you're going to say about product here.
Yes, that Fish and Chip Award is actually sponsored by Norway.
I see this is going to delve into areas which we're never going to get to the bottom of.
But we could quite easily...
Yeah. Okay, I think everyone round the table will say that the fish produced in Scotland is excellent fish and caught by Scottish fishermen is excellent as well. So can I ask members, just before we ask each of those who've given evidence, if there's any other questions that members would like to ask? Sorry, Mike.
I asked in the chamber Mike Russell, the Minister for Brexit, yesterday, what the policy of the Scottish Government was about full membership of the European Union. And Mike Russell's response in the chamber yesterday was that the Scottish Government's aim is to have full membership of the European Union. So there could be a scenario where we leave the European Union and after a referendum we come back into the European Union. I wondered whether anybody had any thoughts about that.
I think I understand your question. I wonder if that may be one better to left hanging at the moment, because that may open up a whole lot more. Maybe John, you had a different question, I think.
Yes, I mean, my question would be, if in Bertie Armstrong's perfect world we do have a huge increase in our catch, will that be spread around amongst more vessels and more owners, or would it just make the existing, what I think are quite a small number of big ships, a lot richer?
Very good question. We wrote specifically as part of our suite of evidence for this whole issue an inshore paper, and it would be perverse if we just ended up with the present catches swelling. That doesn't work. There is an opportunity here to spread the largesse or to spread the opportunity much further, and we're committed to do that.
Okay, perfect. I think I am going to leave it there and ask, if I may ask the witnesses then, and maybe we could start with you, Scott. Is there anything that you haven't raised? And would you give us one thing that you believe needs to be done to prepare now for leaving the EU?
Yeah, I mean, the one thing I think, if the UK government, being the negotiating government, can get early agreement on the security of EU migrants, I think that would be an early thing, and I think there's certainly pressure in the public domain about that. Whether they've got any control over that, it seems to me that the EU itself's being recalcitrant on that point, but I think that's something that would be helpful for all of us. The only other thing is in our paper, Scottish Government paper, which reads well, Our Scotland's Place in Europe, seeks a differentiated solution, and now we know that if it doesn't get one, there's obviously going to be another referendum. And I don't want to get political here, but I do need to make the point, because I've been instructed that we must make the point. The UK market is absolutely crucial to our future in Scottish farm salmon, and we need to do all we can to ensure that there are no impediments to trade within that market forever, basically.
Okay, Michael, Scott, I'm happy for you to leave it there. Michael, would you like to say something?
Thank you. I would say the one thing that we would like to be made now, so to speak, would be the guarantee of the EU nationals that are already here. And I'm pretty sure that would be for any industry, not just the fish processing sector, but for any industry in our country that's reliant on the EU nationals. It's vital for them. We can't replace them. And other implications, we've touched on all the points I had, the tariff, single market access, sustainability, investment, employment, but there's now the double uncertainty. We came up until last Friday thinking about what's Brexit going to do for us, and before we know what Brexit's going to do for us, we now have this political uncertainty, shall we say, about what Scotland wants to do. Personally, you know, we would have rather have had Brexit dealt with and out of it, seen where the country was, and then dealt with the second question. But
Bertie.
In the briefest possible terms, the implication is there, but not the statement, that the balance of benefit from Brexit, from the sea of opportunity, far outweighs the challenges that are coming our way. And it's just worth saying that, that we regard this whole thing as perhaps the, one of the bright spots. The one point that we would make is that we make a plea to both governments to work together to make absolutely certain that under any constitutional arrangement, that we do not end up back inside the common fisheries policy, because to borrow a phrase from our Norwegian friends, which we were very taken with yesterday, if this is well handled, it will keep the lights on in coastal communities around the whole of the United Kingdom, which wouldn't be kept on otherwise.
Alistair.
I agree with the latter part of Bertie's statement there. We must keep the lights on in rural communities around our coastlines. Furthermore, I think we've got to try and look at this as an opportunity, and if we look at it as an opportunity, it might be an opportunity to bring more of our own folk back into the industry from where we've lost villages, etc. That's the ethos under which we work.
Callum, I'm nervous. on your list.
Two quick things I didn't mention in terms of implications. Bycatch, so it's important that whatever arrangements we have effectively address bycatch of marine birds, marine mammals, basking sharks, turtles. As part of the spatial measures that we think can deliver more benefit and more can be done using them to meet environmental criteria, functional unit management should be looked at. So looking at the actual grounds that fish and shellfish associate with. And the point that needs to be done now before leaving the EU, to echo Bertie and Alistair, it's about all four administrations working together, including Wales and Northern Ireland. The Joint Ministerial Council is a place where that could and should be happening. And they work together in order to come up with governance and management arrangements that are compliant with Aarhus, the Aarhus Convention, irrespective of constitutional arrangements, and that deliver socially just fishing within environmental limits.
Okay.
And environmentally just.
Thank you. Robin, if I could ask you to...
Thank you. Well, I'm really here in a personal capacity, so I don't represent any sector. But one thing I would stress, which I don't think we've said a lot about this morning, is the importance of having a management authority or management authorities in place on day one of Brexit that are well-staffed, equipped with the necessary expertise. And at the moment, it seems to me to be rather unclear as to where this is, whether there's going to, what the relationship will be between a UK authority and the devolved administrations. But we really have to have this sorted out before day one of Brexit. And I also agree with what Callum has said about sustainability. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Can I thank everyone who came to the committee this morning? I think you've left us with food for thought and things to think about. It's been, I think, a very productive meeting, and I thank you for engaging with us. I'm sure during the course of this committee's remit, we may be coming back to you to ask for further information. but on behalf of us all, I'd like to thank you, and I'd like to now briefly suspend the meeting to allow you to go in the committee to reorganise for the next session. Thank you.
I'd like to move to agenda item two, which is on seatbelts on School Transport Scotland Bill. On Wednesday, the 8th of March, the Parliament agreed that the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee should be designated as the lead committee in consideration of the Seatbelts on School Transport Scotland Bill at Stage 1. This is a members' bill introduced by Gillian Martin and supported by the Scottish Government. To begin the committee's scrutiny of the bill, we'd like to take evidence from the Scottish Government officials who are providing support to the member in charge of the bill. And I'd welcome Brendan Rooney and Kenneth Hannaway, and would ask if one of you would like to make an opening statement on the bill, and then we'd like to move on to questions. So who would like to make an opening?
Yes, yeah, that'd be me. Morning, convener and members. Thanks for having us today. Yes, I'll just set out some opening remarks to give you the kind of wider context and how we've got to the position we're in, and then happy to take questions. Safety on the journey to and from school is something that the Scottish Government obviously takes as a matter of pivotal importance. It's borne out in a range of measures taken nationally to keep pupils safe, not just within motor vehicles, but also in relation to youngsters walking or cycling to school. Given the safety benefits of seatbelts are well established and internationally recognised, the proposals in this bill are seen to make a valuable contribution to those wider aims. The development of these legislative proposals have some history to them and are not new to Parliament. They emanate from considerations by the Public Petitions Committee some years ago. Scottish ministers subsequently stated their intention to act and power was devolved via Section 30 order during the previous parliamentary session. The bill follows the introduction of similar measures in Wales after a comparable devolution instrument. Given that the intention to legislate was announced in 2014, it has allowed a substantial amount of engagement with stakeholders and parties involved in the delivery of dedicated school transport. As such, there's been a collaborative approach to the proposals that are before you. Central to all this has been the Seatbelts on School Transport Working Group, which includes key partners such as local government, the bus industry, parenting groups, regional transport partnerships. Additionally, a thorough exercise has been undertaken in partnership with COSLA and the Scottish Local Government Partnership in order to forecast the cost implications of the policy, which are set out in detail in the financial memorandum which has been submitted to committee. The Scottish Government has welcomed the partnership working and the contribution of local government to these endeavours. What's clear from the engagement is that there's a very varied picture nationally regarding dedicated school transport. This ranges from double-decker buses transporting pupils in busy urban settings to single-decker coaches taking youngsters to school on rural A roads. For councils, such provision is linked to statutory duties regarding the distances pupils live from their school within the Education Scotland Act 1980. Grant aided and independent schools align their provision with their own policies. Local authority provision is overwhelmingly delivered via contracts with private bus operators. These vary in size, scope and specification and can be quite different across the country, depending on a council's needs. A local authority can stipulate various measures within a contract, such as the standard of a vehicle or onboard features like CCTV, Wi-Fi or indeed seatbelts. Councils are increasingly writing seatbelts into these contracts. Recent returns show 18 do so on all dedicated transport, school transport already. And the bill aims for this practice to become universal as a matter of law. It will apply to all dedicated transport vehicles, such as buses, coaches, minibuses and taxis, including those owned by local authorities and school providers. Dedicated school transport is quite distinct from the public bus service, which some councils do use to meet their statutory duties by giving pupils season tickets or paying for individual journeys. Extending these legislative measures to that provision would be out with the scope of powers devolved to Holyrood on the issue. The bill's proposals don't mandate specific measures to be taken in respect of individual vehicles, such as whether retrofitting existing buses or coaches with seatbelts, or for a private operator to renew their fleet or reorder their fleet. Such decisions will be for private bus companies, and the industry regularly shows flexibility and adaptability to meet shifting contractual considerations. The grant-aided and independent school sector report that their dedicated to school transport is almost universally provided with seatbelts at present. Also existing UK law means since 2001, all new buses and coaches on UK roads that are not designed for what's classed as urban use have to have seatbelts fitted. Therefore, older vehicles that are taken off the road through wear and tear or just generally, you know, retired from the fleet, and the ones that replace them are more likely to have belts fitted in future. Additionally, with regard to young people with additional support needs or those who may need adjustable straps due to the height of the youngster, the bill's provisions have been drafted to allow for this. The statutory definition of seatbelt, which is used, aligns with UK laws, which stipulate that special belts or restraints can be used in place, for instance, where a young person has mobility issues or maybe in a wheelchair. The law on seatbelt wearing and dedicated school transport remains a reserved matter. However, the bill represents an opportunity to promote successful approaches and wider awareness of the issue. Councils and schools use a variety of methods to regulate behaviour on school buses and to encourage seatbelt wearing, and 18 have obviously already implemented the measures that will be in the bill. Extensive dialogues taking place with local government, parenting groups and other stakeholders, and this will continue to, in order that we produce non-statutory guidance that will help promote good practice around seatbelt wearing that goes alongside any final act. The Scottish Government conducted a three-month public consultation on the proposals last year. The analysis is before committee for consideration. This garnered feedback from organisations and people across civic society, such as parents and schools, with respondees overwhelmingly stating it would be a useful contribution to road safety. Thanks, and we welcome any questions you have.
Thank you, Brendan. I think the first question is coming from Stuart.
I want to ask just a couple of questions about why the bill and why the government supports the bill. And to underpin that, can you tell us how many children are injured travelling in school transport would be affected by this legislation?
There aren't actually figures collated on the number of school children injured on dedicated school transport. Certainly the number of children up to 16 injured on buses and coaches in Scotland is around 45 a year. That's for all provision, though. That's not dedicated school transport, and it's not possible to extrapolate from the figures the precise numbers on dedicated school transport.
And of that 45, have you anything you can indicate to the committee as what proportion of that 45 would not have been injured if seatbelts had been available to that child?
There's not been an analysis done of that. It is worth noting, though, these are children on the bus. If a child had been injured just after disembarking, that would be counted in statistical terms as a pedestrian. So,
Yes, indeed, that's quite a clearly quite a different issue. So it could be as many as 45, but we can expect it to be rather less than that. So let me try and come at it from a slightly different angle. Can you tell us anything about the nature of the injuries the 45 suffered? In other words, are they comparatively minor ones, or are they significant injuries, or a mix?
Of those average, three are on average annually were serious, and 42 were what's deemed as slight in statistical terms. So,
right. So basically, we've got the statistical underpinnings, and I've had constituents who've been on the case of this bill for a long time, and I've supported them in doing so. But given the progress that seems to be being made and the numbers you're giving us, why is the government supporting this bill?
Well, the government's stated intention for the legislation does go back a number of years to the previous administration during the last parliamentary session. I mean, as stated at the beginning, I mean, seatbelts are a well-established safety mechanism, and government feels that there would be a useful contribution to road safety on the school run.
I think that's it, Commissioner.
I think we can take that up with Gillian Martin when she comes in. I've got a question, if I may, for you. Could you just explain to me the idea of why it was 2018 for primary schools and 2021 for secondary schools, and why there was a decided to make a differentiation there?
Yeah, I can do. Yes, the proposal is for the measures to be phased in and to come in, the legal obligation to come in 2018 for primary school vehicles and 2021 for secondary. There has been extensive dialogue with those who deliver the provision, i.e. the bus industry and councils. The transition needed is greater within the vehicles used for secondary school. More of those aren't currently fitted with seatbelts. So the timescale was arrived at in consultation and collaboration with those delivering it. To accelerate it, the feedback we got was that it would put quite significant pressure on councils and the bus industry and could lead to contracts being broken, which may greatly increase costs on local government.
Understand that, but one of the questions that Stuart asked you was to do with injuries, and you indicated that some of the injuries recorded, the 45 injuries recorded, of which two were serious, were for people under the age of 16, and you were unable to say whether what split that was. I mean, it might be that more secondary school pupils are injured on buses than primary school pupils, and therefore there might be an increased need to accelerate that. Was that considered when the bill was brought forward?
It was considered, yes. I mean, it has been looked at. Implementation dates were discussed and a sort of range of options. There's obviously a balance to be found there. It is the safety. The statistics we have, we can't differentiate between secondary and primary, so I can't actually give you the split there.
That may be a question that I'd take forward with Gillian. John, do you want to come in with that?
You finished your
yes,
bit.
Yes, absolutely, yeah.
You said when you were speaking earlier that it doesn't cover registered bus services, and I understand that, but am I right in saying it doesn't also cover school trips? And I'd be a little bit puzzled by that if the children were brought to school with a compliant bus but were taken to the swimming baths or something without it.
Yeah, it's correct that the bill as drafted at present doesn't cover school trips. School trips are subject to quite stringent and robust risk assessment that's done and placing duties on what's called the group leader, which in effect is usually a teacher, which stipulates seatbelts are to be booked on the buses that they use. There is quite a distinct provision in that home-to-school transport is organised at sort of local authority level for local authority-wide, whereas a school trip is often a teacher booking a bus for their individual class. There is a system in place there's guidance in place that promotes seatbelts and stipulates that they should be booked on that. But it's right that the bill's currently drafted doesn't cover school trips.
Okay. Sorry, can I just push that? Because I think that's a very interesting point. I mean, the guidance for teachers is to book seatbelts, but there's no obligation apart from the guidance. I mean, it's not a legal requirement to have seatbelts, is it? Is that what you're saying on school visit? Because I think that parents would find that difficult to understand the split between the two, which is the point John's making.
Yes, I mean, that's right. There isn't a legal obligation on teachers to or group leaders to ensure seatbelts are. I mean, in practice, it's universally, feedback is that it's universally done and the guidance is very well adhered to, but that's correct. The bill as drafted doesn't cover that provision.
Okay, Mike, do you want to come in on that?
Edward's line of questioning on this. Just explain to me, would you please, is it a devolved power to legislate, to ensure that school trips use seatbelts where they are provided? Is that devolved to us or not? Is that a UK legislative authority?
No, that is devolved. You know, that is.
So we could do it now. We could do it in this bill.
Technically, I believe.
Okay. Yes. Thank you. An amendment, perhaps.
Okay. Maybe we can consider that further. Richard, the next question was from you.
Good morning. As a grandfather, I could take my grandkids to school. I have to have two seats in the back with seat belts, and I've got to ensure that they're well fastened in. But yet we still have 18 local authorities who already require all dedicated transport to be fitted with seat belts. We've got 32 councils, so 14 of them are not, and a further 6 who are requiring some contracts that as services for primary school pupils or a particular type of vehicle that they need seatbelts. You made an interesting comment about the factor of new buses coming on, but there's still 110 buses which have not been fitted with seatbelts. And I would contend that, with the greatest respect, most of these buses are quite old. If you look at the buses that are going about and spewing out their diesel as they go along the road. Fumes, you'll be interested in that, John, I suppose. But basically, the situation is, why have these other authorities, and this has not been on the go for the last couple of years, this has been on the go for a number of years. Why have the other authorities totally not insisting that we have seatbelts on these buses? Is it because the people who have tendered still have buses which are ancient and they don't want to spend the money to bring them up to standard? Or is it a case of not insisting that they've got to change them and get it sorted?
Yeah, there's a couple of points there. I think it's a variety of issues from council to council. Certainly, I think it is a fair assumption that some of these buses will be older vehicles. When I said at the beginning, since 2001, there is, as I said, any new bus that comes onto the UK road would have to have seatbelts fitted unless it's designed for urban use. So that means double-deckers essentially are designed for urban use. And if it has standing room, so you'll see single-deckers used on commercial bus services that don't have seatbelts fitted. And it's the stipulation around having standing room, which means it's designed for urban use. So larger coaches that are often used in more rural authorities, given the faster roads and the more rural environment, are more likely to already adhere to those wider UK laws. It's certainly fair to say that councils have also been increasingly doing this since the ministerial announcement was made in 2014. So there has been, over recent years, an increased number doing it in preparation for the legislation. Given that we knew powers were being devolved via Section 30 order, there was a good amount of time to engage with councils and the bus industry to help them get ready for this and make the transition. And that has been borne out in the feedback we've had, that it's increasingly happening in the run-up to legislative measures.
You're basically saying that the buses that have been fitted in rural are being fitted in rural areas and council areas or council authorities in that area. But one area I'm particularly interested in, because it's near my area, it falls within the Glasgow, sort of South Ayrshire, East Renfrewshire, Western Bartonshire area. It comes under the SPT, Strathclyde Passenger Transport. Why is it heavily that they don't have seatbelts fitted? Is it something that is particularly averse in the SPT area?
I mean, I don't know if the committee will take evidence from SPT. Certainly, they contract for a number of local authorities in the west of Scotland, and so do run quite an extensive number of contracts with various bus operators. Feedback from SPT to us is that they're increasingly writing in the seatbelt stipulation as we move towards legislation. I can't say categorically the decisions they make on individual contracts. I mean, as with any other local authority or regional transport partnership, the option is there for them to write seatbelts in. It may well depend on provision in the area and you know what bus operators are offering, but I can't vouch for the decisions that they would personally make.
The implications of the bill, what will that mean for the SPT? You know, is it a case that SPT are pushing the operators or not pushing the operators because they don't want to rock the boat, or is it a case that as the contracts come up and are renewed, that then they can turn around and say, you need to put in seatbelts?
Yes, I think it would be done when contracts are renewed rather than partway through a contract, as that could be quite difficult to change the terms of a contract midway through. It's certainly fair to say feedback to Scottish Government has been that SPT are increasingly writing this into contracts and they are phasing this in as it progresses towards legislation. As I say, they do have a wide number of contracts for various local authorities, so my understanding is that they don't categorically do it on all of them at the moment, but they are increasingly moving towards it.
Thanks very much, Kevin.
Okay, thank you, Richard. Mike, I think you've got some questions on enforcement.
Thank you very much, Kevin. Can I just first of all say I think it's an absolutely right idea that we have seatbelts in schools. The point of the committee's work now is to interrogate the bill and to see whether actually the bill is fit for purpose for the process. My questions really focus on enforcement. I mean, as I understand it, correct me if I'm wrong, that if we pass this bill and therefore we require school transport to have seatbelts, we're not requiring them to be used. Is that right?
To be worn, you mean?
Yeah.
Well, that's a reserve. That is a still a reserved issue. So there aren't actually powers out.
So we can't legislate for that.
Not to to put a duty on.
But when I asked you just now whether we could legislate for school trips for people to use this, you said we did have the power.
Oh, sorry. That's perhaps my perhaps not been clear. Not we can't legislate on any provision for the wearing of seatbelts, but we could. Legislation could be passed to mean they have to be fitted.
Not on school trips either.
Okay, no,
I got that clear now. Okay. So my question, therefore, is if we can't enforce this, if we pass this law, and so the law is purely about getting the things fitted, is this the right way to go about it? I mean, has the Scottish Government, I think everybody's supportive of this process, has the Scottish Government asked the UK Government to use the legislative power it has to put a bill through that would allow both fitting and the enforcement of the use? Has that question been asked by the Scottish Government?
To my knowledge, it hasn't. I could write to committee with some further. I'm not certain. My thought is that it hasn't, but I think there may well be a reluctance to devolve beyond the scope of
I'm not
what,
talking about devolving. I'm asking whether the Scottish Government has asked the UK Government to legislate for this, because what I'm fearful of are we spend time in this committee, in the Parliament, passing this legislation, which I want to see effective. We have a big tick in the box, oh, job done. And then we find kids are still being injured. So I really want whoever does it to have the best solution. And I just wanted to check. It would be very helpful if you could let the committee know in writing, therefore, to the convener, whether the Scottish Government has asked the UK Government to do this, so we don't go off half-cock, as it were.
Brendan, could you just clarify, is it a legal requirement to wear a seatbelt on a bus in the United Kingdom?
Kenny, would you be better to...
Well, maybe it comes back, convener, to Mr. Rumble's point. The wearing of seatbelts is a fairly intricate, as you might imagine, set of statutory provisions that cover that. The short answer to your question is no. There are various exceptions, exemptions. I think, Brendan, one of the examples is actually children under 14 and particular types of vehicle coaches. Although that is something that I think there's an EU directive which has not yet been implemented by the EFT, but is under consideration. So there's a framework, and you know it's not universally applicable. But I can maybe just help clarify as well the point. I don't know if it was adequately clarified or not for Mr. Rumbles, but the sort of question as to what's reserved devolved. I think I took from your earlier point. It was more about the question of we're doing a particular thing with this bill in relation to effectively school transport from and to between home and school, which is right. And I think your question was, could that be widened out to school trips during the day, etc.? And the answer to that question is yes, because the Section 30 order talks about effectively devolves this sort of thing, if I can put it that way, in relation to arrangements for persons travelling to and from places where they receive education or training. So, you know, the thing that we're doing here is a specific, you know, category between home and school, but that could be widened out to school trips.
It's not about the actual wearing or enforcement of any, so there's no enforcement about
it's
this.
That's exactly right. It's the requirement that education authorities will have in their contracts that buses provided, used for this type of provision, will have seatbelts fitted. Yeah.
I understand what you've just told me. I'm going to look at this, if I may, from somebody whose child is on a bus and just say something horrific happens and they get injured on the bus. They turn around and they say the Scottish Government made it law that seatbelts had to be fitted on the bus. But there's no requirement of anyone to wear a seatbelt on the bus. So the onus is on the school teachers to make it an acceptable practice to wear the seatbelt on the bus. And therefore, what we're saying is the Scottish Government is saying, fit seatbelts, school teachers have got to encourage children to do it, job done. It doesn't think, I don't think that parents in Scotland
would feel that that was right. I wondered if that's a question we should be asking the minister, or is that your point, Mike?
I mean, we've got a whole system of enforcement questions because they're legitimate ones. But what I'm taking from the answers from the officials is that actually there is no enforcement about this in legislative terms. This bill, before, as I understand it, correct me if I'm wrong, it's only coming to light now. This bill before us is purely about a technical aspect of having seatbelts fitted. It's not about any other issue about whether kids are safe travelling to and from school on buses with seatbelts fitted. And I think if we're going to take legislation through, we should be comprehensive and attack the problem, which we all foresee is there and the potential, rather go off half-cock on this, if I can use that expression, with a bill that doesn't cover what people's worries are.
Can I just say, slightly in defence, that I probably jumped the gun by making that comment, because we are having two evidence sessions with people, and I think those are the questions we can reasonably ask, whether it's a... Richard, do you want
to... On the point the convener just said there, it's not school teachers who'll be on a bus at 8 o'clock in the morning, it'll be the bus driver taking the kids from the farthest away point to the school. So actually, it'll be the bus driver who'll need to say to the kids, put your seatbelt on. Now, I don't see the bus driver stopping every 2 minutes to check to see if people have got their seatbelt on. So, you know, the point Mr. Rumble's made is quite valid, and the point the convener's made. So who's going to be liable for enforcement, if there is any enforcement?
Richard, I'm not sure that
just these two
gentlemen may give us the answer, and it's maybe something we could take up. I mean, if you want to give us a short answer to that, is that correct, what he's saying, what Richard is saying?
Well, yeah, just very briefly, yes. I mean, the legal measures around that on seatbelt wearing are the reserved to Westminster and overseen by a sort of EU framework. In terms of what happens in practice, the councils have various ways of monitoring and improving behaviour on school buses. Some of them use bus monitors, so it's not always just the driver. Some use prefects or older children who help the youngsters put their belts on. We've had a lot of engagement with local government on this, and there seems to be quite innovative measures that do take place. And as I was setting out at the start, we do envisage quite comprehensive guidance that will help look at the best approaches to this. But it is fair to say that legislation on that matter is out with the scope of the powers that have been devolved that the bill takes forward.
John, I think you wanted to make a comment.
Convener, that is, I mean, the officials have obviously been given charged with doing a job, and they're doing it very thoroughly, and I sense the frustrations that Mike and indeed yourself have, and it might be appropriate for this committee to seek the devolution of the necessary powers that have caused the frustration here, because, I mean, it's one of a range of frustrations that some of us might have about, but that presumably is an option that we could...
I think the committee needs to consider whether the bill is achieving what it's setting out to do, which is safeguarding children. And I think that is the critical thing that we need to consider. John wanted to come in. I take the point you're making. John.
On finance?
Okay. No, sorry. Just on this. Sorry.
Sorry.
Okay, a technical one. I'll walk on that.
Because you said that good practice amongst local authorities is that they have somebody on... Would it be in the powers? Could we put an amendment to this to save this bill? Could we put an amendment to the bill, which would put a duty on local authorities to have some sort of person, whatever it is, on the bus to make sure that they can do that? Just a thought.
I could.
Is that within our powers, legislative powers?
We would have to write to the committee. Certainly that is a different issue from the Section 30 instrument that devolved power on fitting of seatbelts. That was something we'd have to look at more widely.
Okay. Stuart and then Redder, if I may.
Just to be clear, I'm on the same subject, but I want to engage directly in the drafting of the bill. It may be if Rhoda's question might properly precede mine.
My question is about a duty of care, because while there is no legal responsibility, people send their children to school, and when they hand them over to the authority, that's local parentis or whatever. If the child was in an accident without wearing their seatbelt, one would imagine the parent would have come back against the authority because they weren't acting in local parentis and they weren't making sure that the child was being, so under kind of health and safety and negligence legislation, there might be a comeback.
I'm happy, Brendan, that you're looking as though you want to consider that, whether it would be writing back to the committee before we take our evidence session, because I think that is a key question which runs through the themes of the points that people have made.
Yeah, most certainly we'll take those away and
Stuart.
And set them out.
Addressing this to officials, because I'm presuming the drafting of the bill lay in your purview. Essentially, of the six sections, there are two active sections, and that's sections one and section four. And I take that also from the commencement arrangements, which essentially commence those two sections at a later date chosen by ministers. Now, section one is commendably brief, and it says a school authority must ensure that each motor vehicle, da-da-da-da, has a seatbelt for each passenger seat. That's fine. But section four, on the face of it, appears to introduce some doubt, because it now requires each school authority to provide a compliance statement each year on whether they have done what in section one they must do. And I just wonder whether it's something that I'm going to see the answer to in the secondary legislation under transitional transitory saving provisions comes along, that will show that the must element is not immediate but phased. Is that a correct hypothesis that I'm bringing forward?
Yeah. I think that's right, Mr. Stevenson. I think the plan is there are the high level dates. There's, as you say, the section one duty, but there will be an intention that the sort of transition, because you'll recall that there's I think no intention at this stage to be requiring authorities to break contracts. So the nuts and bolts of the transition will, I think, come exactly to your point.
So the whole point of having section four, which if one were to read simply section one, appears to be pointless. The whole point of section four is because we expect it to be phased, and therefore we require authorities to produce annual reports so that we can monitor as a parliament what's going on, which leads then to just a modest supplementary question. I presume at some point where all authorities are reporting 100% compliance, we'll be able to suspend the requirement in section four, rather than forevermore receive reports from authorities that tell us what we already knew.
Thank you. I'll just note that, I think. Thank you. It's very helpful.
Yep. Good. Thank you.
The final question, if I may, relates to finance, and I think John wants to start on that.
Yes. Thanks, Convener. As I understand it, the financial memorandum, we're talking about £8.92 million as the cost of this. I mean, part of me wonders why there's any cost, because if 18 local authorities have achieved seatbelts on buses, presumably just because gradually the buses have improved, as they would have done with disabled access, if lower emissions, a whole lot of improvements on buses generally, why do we feel we have to give MD any money to improve the buses in this regard?
Yeah, I mean, the costs are the knock-on effect on increased contract costs, essentially, the local government's outlay. So by putting more stipulations on a contract, it generally leads to a cost increase. So so by adding extra stipulations, contract costs do go up. That's how the figures have been arrived at. I mean, they were conducted... It is quite challenging to isolate the actual precise cost, because there are a range of options that would be open to a private bus operator to meet a contract. And so essentially there are forecasts that are based on the contracting authority, councils essentially, taking a forecast into the future on what previous increases have been and essentially applying that to future contracts. So they're based on a forecast of increased contract costs into the future. It is fair to say, as we've discussed, that some buses may well go out of service anyway or may not. I mean, the Scottish Government does have an understanding with local government that any what are called new burdens are costed you know, and robustly looked at in financial terms. And that's the exercise that we undertook with local government, which has arrived at those figures.
I suppose 2 points. Firstly, it would appear to be rewarding the bad authorities who haven't done what they should have done before, and the 18 authorities who presumably have found the money by trimming their library services or something, are kind of losing out, it would appear. And it means 8.92 million, if my maths is correct, is that 89,000 per bus if it's 100 buses?
Well, as I say, it's not something that's been worked out at a per bus cost. It's a yearly annual increase. The distribution of it isn't only to the 18 councils. I mean, COSLES and the SLGP do negotiate on behalf of all their members, and it's not something that it would have seemed fair that councils who had already done this didn't receive some kind of financial recompense for it. So it is the national local government figure. It's not a breakdown between 18. I mean, the precise distribution of which is something that's worked out, as all local government funding is, in negotiation with local government representative bodies and looked at in the block sort of grant. So it's not a local authority sort of breakdown council by council.
Okay, well, I'll leave it at that. But
I feel that you may be asking this question again at an evidence session later. Rhoda, do you want to come in on the back of that?
How will the additional money be distributed? Because, you know, John's talking about some councils who have got good practice being penalised, but at the same time, the councils who haven't done this have done it maybe because they can't afford to do it. So if the money's going into the normal block grant, then everyone gets a share, and some councils will be out of pocket by having to recontract for a higher price. It's fraught with, I suppose, unfairness, because do you penalise one or do you not fully compensate the other?
Yeah, I mean, I suppose it's fair to say that we are officials from the Transport Department, and local government financing perhaps isn't something we're immensely immersed in the nuances of. My understanding, though, is the settlement and distribution, this is looking at local government as a whole. Exactly how much is apportioned to individual local authorities is something that is decided at in conjunction with local government and the Scottish Government in the round of the block settlement. So we're not in a position to give a detailed breakdown of what money is going where. That the overall costs in the financial memorandum make a forecast on the national figure to local government. There isn't a breakdown of what is going at this stage as what is going to individual councils.
Get that as part of the bill consideration, because obviously that's going to be one of the things that's going to come to us as a committee.
Yeah, we'll certainly look at what at this stage can be, you know, what we can give to committee at this stage that and endeavour to give us as much information as we can on how that will be in the future distributed.
There's one further question from Richard, and he's promised it's going to be a quick one.
Thank you, Convener. It will be a quick one. I just can't get, I could never get it when I was a local authority councillor, that if you want to provide a bus for me to run the school children to there, you should provide the seatbelts. So why should it be a cost to the council? If the person wants a contract, should it not be a cost to the contractor?
I mean, I suppose those are probably things that better directed at councils and private contractors. But certainly, our understanding is stipulating extra measures within a contract leads to increased costs. That there isn't a specific binary sort of unit cost for that, because things like, with any contract, things like competition in an area and the amount of provision will mean that in an area where there is a lot of competition, those bidding for contracts are more likely to have to be more competitive and look at keeping their prices down.
But you're stipulating, someone raised earlier, I haven't got it right in front of me, but it's going to be a couple of years for primary and then a number of years for secondary. By that time, surely all these contracts should be out of vogue, and new contracts should come in, and we turn around and say, bring your new bus and you can have the contract. It's that simple, isn't it?
Richard, I think your point is well made, and Gideon, when she comes in, and the other stakeholders that come
it's
in,
a question
maybe,
asking,
right? Maybe, yeah. Maybe able to
Thank
answer
you.
That. I think we'll
stop that there, if I may. We're going to take two further evidence sessions, which will include Gillian Martin coming in. So I'd like to thank you both for attending the meeting and informing us. There are a few matters which the clerking team will be in contact with you requesting further information, and I'd be grateful if you could let us have those as soon as possible. So I'm going to briefly suspend the meeting to allow you to leave. I would ask members to remain in their seats, if I may. Please. Thank you. Okay, the third item on the agenda is the consideration of two negative instruments as detailed in the agenda. The committee would I'd ask the committee now to consider any issues that it wishes to raise in reporting to the Parliament on these instruments. Members should note that no motions to annul have been received in relation to these instruments, and there have also been no representation to the committee on the instruments. However, I know there are one or two members of the committee who would like to make comment, and I would like to ask John Finney to start that, if I may, please.
Thanks very much indeed, Convener. I'd like to speak on the inshore fisheries prohibition of fishing and fishing methods, Outer Hebrides Order 2017. And in particular, to say that it's not my intention to move to have it annulled, but I would like to highlight some points in it, which I think the committee may at some future date wish to pick up on. No one would take objection, I doubt, with the policy objective as outlined there of the protection of fish stocks. It then goes on to say, and better reflect current fishing practices. And we do know that that there is a blanket ban on fishing in some areas. A constituent has been in touch with me and shared correspondence that the Scottish Government have had with him in the form of Marine Scotland. And if I may quote a couple of passages, please. It says, now, turning to your main concern, that a precedent is being set whereby if scallop dredging is prohibited in an area, then diving for scallops may be similarly curtailed. And I think we're in the territory here, which even experts tell me is quite complex, about overlapping areas of responsibility and I'm not going to details on that, but... then goes on to say, on your questions of over the proposed benefits of the closure, the amendment will bring diving for scallops into line with current restrictions on dredging for scallops and help to effort effort in fisheries. These are two entirely different situations. One is a sustainable method. One of them is entirely destructive, and people need only take a cursory examination online to see video footage of the effect of these. So I then come to what is in the policy note under the financial effects, where it says, in relation to the business and regulated impact assessment, the policy will better complement current fishing practices, I don't accept that, by helping ensure that fish are caught at times that are most suitable for market conditions. Well, I don't think conservation should be driven by market conditions. And I would ask, what's the situation out with these times? But my principal frustration with this is that who will monitor this? Who will police this regime? Because unless we have adequate enforcement, and it's my understanding that that will be very challenging. We've got a series of maps here. You can see the locations. You can see everything else. Unless there's enforcement, then on the last day before closure or the first day of closure, a dredger could go through there, cause immeasurable damage that wouldn't be impacted by more sustainable methods like the diver. So I think there's a question of proportionality here. I don't think that... is being achieved. If you sense frustration in my voice, is that I think there are shortcomings here. I would hope at some future point, and I'm aware that I'm not shy at making suggestions for our work programme, but at some point, if we looked at this, I think this is going to be an issue following on from some of our stuff with Brexit and fishing this morning here. I would like us at some future date to consider what the cumulative impact of these various orders are and the monitoring that will take place to ensure they're complied with, because I'm concerned that what we have here is a big bundle of paper that means nothing except it's affecting those who are actually going about their business in a sustainable way.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, John. Stuart, did you want to make a comment?
Yes, please. One of the things I did was go and look at the consultation responses, of which there were 10, and 9 of which had been published, one for whatever reason has been withheld. It's worth making the point, of course, that this is an update to a 30-year-old plan. It is not creating new areas on the map. It is changing the boundaries and changing. So the only new area appears to be the Loch Rogue area. Which is to prohibit static gear fishing for shellfish during 3 months. And that's designed to help protect the area's shellfish stocks. And certainly, as one reads the detail, that appears to be the intention. And looking at the responses to the consultation, while there was arguments on both sides, both in favour and against, I think the thrust of it was pretty firmly in favour of what the government has brought forward. But I think I absolutely make common cause with John that this is a highly complex area, and it is in very particular local areas often quite controversial. My knowledge of that is precisely why I went unusually and read all the consultation responses, which I wouldn't normally do in something like this. And I think it is proper at some point that we consider for the work programme the general subject of the inshore fisheries, because these are small numbers in macroeconomic terms, but hugely economically important to very small and vulnerable communities. So I think it's quite proper that John makes that point. I would not wish to see this impeded. I think it should proceed.
Can I make an observation, and then if I may bring in Rada on this, is that I rather, like you, John, looked at all the maps and tried to equate to people on the ground and the effect it would have on individuals as well as to the actual environment. And I find that quite difficult to do. So although you might not want me to align myself too closely to you, I probably do in this situation. And I think that the one thing that this committee will have the opportunity to do during the course of this session is the government has promised to bring forward a bill on inshore fisheries, and I would like to see that us consider this in a lot more detail at that stage. So I rather, like Stuart, don't want to stop this going ahead, and I suspect like you, John, but I did find it difficult to understand and to make relevant comment on based on the information that was provided. Now I'd like to let Rhoda make a comment and then go to Richard and then maybe put this to the committee for a decision. So, Rhoda.
Just very quickly, and for those reasons, I asked local Fishermen's Association about this because I didn't know how it would work on the ground, and I was told that it was part of the Inshore Fisheries Group negotiations. They'd worked extensively on this. They were happy with it and felt that this was a good way of decision making because they'd, you know, the fishing interest had been involved. So, you know, while I worry about some of the instruments coming towards us, this one seems to have been welcomed to an extent. I mean, not everyone will be happy with all of it, but it seems at least have been, the decision seemed to have been made based on the needs of the local area and conservation, and I think there's a balance to be struck.
Richard, would you like to?
Well, I take connection to the point that John Finney was making, but I know it's Marine Scotland Compliance responsible for monitoring. Fishery officers have the power, etc. But I also agree that we should be looking in our work programme at especially comments this morning from Alistair Sinclair, National Coordinator, Scottish Creel Fishermen's Federation. There's other things that we should be looking at, you know, within, you know, there's the big 200 mile away fishing, but there's also a lot of fishing within the actual country of Scotland.
So can I take it from the committee that when we need to delve into this more when the inshore fisheries come up and there are things that we need to look at, but can I take it therefore that on the basis of that we don't want to make any recommendations in relation to this instrument? Is that agreed by the committee? Okay, thank you. That concludes today's meeting. I would ask as we're going. Sorry, the animal feed order. Sorry, we need to do that as well. Are there any comments on that? Sorry, I apologise.
No comment.
Okay, thank you. No, but it is technically correct, and I thank you for that. So.
So can I just say that the committee has agreed that it does not want to make any recommendation in relation to either of these instruments. Is that agreed? Okay, thank you. I'd like to now suspend the meeting, or close the meeting, sorry.